All right, we are live now. So this is going to be on YouTube after we're done. So why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself to the Atheist Republic community and let us know a little bit about your views and your activity as an activist. And then we could go from there, yeah.
Thank you so much, first of all, for having me, Armin. It's a pleasure connecting with you, first on Facebook and now here. And hopefully we can continue to be in connection with regards to the common things that we fight for in the future as well. Briefly, my name is Kashif Chaudhry, and I'm originally from Pakistan. I came to the United States about 8 years ago after I completed my medical school in Pakistan. I did my residency training here in New Jersey. I was in New York, and now I'm in Boston. And I'm completing a cardiology fellowship in Boston currently. I started writing for a human rights cause that I was passionately interested in and affected by a few years ago because I belong to a community of Muslims known as the Ahmadiyya Muslim Community. This is a minority Muslim community in Pakistan. We are about 5 million out of a total population, about 180 million in Pakistan. And we are persecuted for some of our beliefs. And I started writing about that, about 5 to 6 years ago when I came to the US. Since then, my writing has evolved. And, along the way, while I was writing for the human rights of Ahmadis and other people in Pakistan, I met a lot of other people. I made friends with a lot of other people who were fighting for similar causes, which include people of all religions, of all faiths, and even people of no faith. So for example, just about a year or so ago, I met Kyle Jones. He's an amazing friend of mine. He's an atheist. And we decided to form a group called Atheist and Ahmadi Muslims for Freedom of Conscience. And we use this group to fight for freedom of conscience for atheist people, for example, in Bangladesh and Saudi Arabia, and Ahmadi Muslims and other Muslims and everyone in general in the world, anywhere where they are made prisoners of conscience. Now, my activism briefly speaking, it evolves around freedom of conscience, human rights, and also explaining to people what my true faith is. That's another aspect of my activism as well. For example, sometimes I feel like people label their understanding of Islam that they get from some other place, like let's say ISIS, on me. And I feel like it's my responsibility to correct that perception of Islam. And that's another another aspect of my activism as well.
Okay, so a lot of the based on the conversations that we had on Facebook and some of the writings that you had, a lot of the views that you have contradict what most people assume a Muslim view would be.
That's right.
And to be honest, I know a lot of people, a lot of Muslims that have your view, but most Muslims that I know of will disagree with some of the views that you have, and we could bring that up. But this is my first time that I actually managed to talk to a Muslim with these views. So a lot of times I know even Muslims that support freedom of speech, freedom of expression, freedom to criticize Islam, secularism, and these values, even though they feel comfortable typing about it sometimes they right. don't really want to, they feel they're a little bit afraid of the backlash to talk about it this openly, right? So yeah. some of the views that you have, like you're saying you support freedom of expression and freedom of
speech. Course. Yeah, yes. Without a doubt. Without a doubt.
Does Definitely. That includes freedom to criticize Islam?
Yeah, so let me just give you a brief background of where my beliefs come from, and that, I don't want people to get the impression that I'm one of maybe just a handful of people. I'm part of a group of Muslims, which is actually the fastest evolving group within Muslims in the world today. To answer your direct question first before I delve into details, yes, I believe that there should be complete freedom to criticize any ideology, any idea, including Islam. Where I come from is, from the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. This is a community of Muslims. We're in the tens of millions in the world. We are organized in about 206 countries in the world so far. And we are united under a Khalifa, who is the spiritual leader of the community. But we believe in spiritual caliphate, not in political caliphate. It's a completely apolitical community. We believe that Prophet Muhammad brought the religion of Islam to mankind. And since then, over hundreds and hundreds of years, it has been distorted. And the current form that we see, for example, that is rife in most of the Muslim countries, Saudi Arabia, Iran, or whatever, is not the true form of Islam that is found in the Quran and that was brought to us by the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. If we look into the prophecies regarding this age, the latter age, we do realize, as I detailed in one of my recent articles on ISIS as well, that he had clearly prophesied that there would be a time when there would be nothing of Islam but its name, and there would be rise in religious extremism, there would be a group of people who would take up the, do evil deeds in the name of Islam. And in this age, there would be a reformer who would come to reform Islam and bring the true message of Islam back to the people. In 1889, there was a person in India by the name of Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, who claimed to be the Messiah or the Imam Mahdi. As you know, many Muslims wait for this figure called the Imam Mahdi. So he started the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, which I'm a part of and a member of. And he clarified, we uphold free dialogue and debate, and we show that there is nothing in the Quran, for example, in support of the apostasy laws. There's nothing in the Quran that supports the blasphemy laws. There's nothing in the Quran that supports the notion of violent jihad, the way that you see extremists espouse that vision. And there's nothing in the Quran says that Islam must be imposed on people, which is why we openly condemn apostasy laws. We openly condemn blasphemy laws wherever they exist in the Muslim world. We uphold the separation of church and state, and we believe that there's no reason for a state to interfere with the personal faith of people. Everyone is free to either believe in a religion or not to believe in a religion. I mean, everyone is free to be Christian, Jew, Muslim, or even an atheist. So and everyone is free to criticize any other ideology openly. Those are the values that we uphold and we preach.
Okay, so a few questions. First of all, with regards to, there's so many different things that I want to touch on here. You mentioned that, what you're saying is true Islam, what other people are saying is not true Islam, and we could come back to that later. But first I want to say, so do all Ahmadi Muslims believe in, freedom of expression for...
Yes.
So this is something in general for all Ahmadi Muslims, right?
Oh, yes.
You're saying how many of them are out there?
There are tens of millions. I mean, there are different estimates because in certain countries in the Muslim world, we are persecuted, so we don't have exact figures. But they're in the tens of millions, and according to one estimate, it's 160 million. So, not to exaggerate them, it's tens of millions is a correct estimate.
Okay. And you do acknowledge that most Muslims will not consider, most Muslims will not consider Ahmadi Muslims Muslims.
There are many Muslims, and actually the number of Muslims who consider Ahmadis Muslim is growing now. About 5 to 10 years ago, I rarely saw a Muslim who would acknowledge that I'm a Muslim. But now there's a growing community of Sunni and Shia Muslims who consider us Muslims as well.
It's growing, but it's still a minority, right?
I think so. And I think the reason for that is ignorance. People don't know about Ahmadi Muslims.
Okay.
But if you talk about the clergy, you're right. Most of the clerics who are Sunni and Shia, they do not consider a Muslim. That is a correct statement.
Okay. And when you... So And you're saying to when I if I talk to any of these Ahmadi Muslims, if I say, like, do you think it's okay for me to criticize or even ridicule Islam, they say, I have the right to do that.
Correct.
Okay, that's
good. No doubt about that.
Right. So I think it's important for people, even if these Muslims, I mean, tens of millions is a large number, even if it's a minority. And I think it's something that a lot of people should recognize that there are Muslims. What would you say to Muslims that I'm going to come back to the idea of what the Quran teaches and what Islam teaches and what's the true Islam and what's not true Islam. But I want to first get an idea of what would you say to Muslims that think that that say Islam is the true religion, right? And me as an atheist have no right to come say something that they find offensive about their religion.
Sure. So, you know, what I would say to such Muslims is to read the Quran. The Quran says that there's no compulsion in religion. It also says in another place that let him who will believe and let him who will disbelieve. So the task assigned to Prophet Muhammad was not to impose religion on people or to force people to accept Islam, but it's stated again and again and again in the Quran that the task of Prophet Muhammad was only to deliver the message, not to impose it. So right. That's what I say to these Muslims. Like, you have no right to do what Prophet Muhammad did not do. You have no right to do what the Quran explicitly forbids you to do. In Surah Kafirun, I'm sure you're aware, that says, if someone doesn't have the same belief as you, what you say to them is, for you, your religion, and for me, my religion. I mean,
what if that Muslim replies to you, what would you say to that Muslim if he or she says, yes, they can have whatever religion they want, and I'm not going to force Islam on them, but they have no right to criticize Islam. They could be atheists if they want, or they could be Christian if they want, but they should not ridicule Islam, they should not criticize Islam, and they should not have that right to do that, even if they're free to stay atheists, but they should not say offensive things about Islam.
Again, I would tell them to read the Quran, and the answer is in the Quran, because in the Quran it says you will have people. So there are two different things. One is criticism of Islam, and second is ridicule of Islam. And I'll separate the two, and I think people should have right to do both. They can criticize Islam and they can ridicule Islam if they want to. You know, any idea can be criticized and ridiculed. I think they should have the right to do both. Whether it is right to do both is another issue. Personally, I believe that ridiculing doesn't serve any positive purpose. I think that we should elevate our speech, and instead of just, you know, baselessly ridiculing religion or baselessly ridiculing people who are sacred to certain religions, I think we should promote intellectual dialogue instead. For example, we should have open dialogue on, are apostasy laws right? Should blasphemy laws of Pakistan be repealed?
Ridicule can be intellectual.
Like in what way, for example?
I mean, ridicule doesn't have to be targeting people. Ridicule can be targeting ideas, right? For example, if somebody says, ridicules atheism, like somebody says, like, really? Like, atheists think that everything was made randomly without any intelligent design. Like, I don't know, maybe they could come up with a joke with it about it. I mean, I disagree with that view, but maybe they could bring more attention to it by putting, you know, ridicule to it. I mean, I support them expressing their views in that format.
No, I completely support them. But what I'm saying is, you're right. There can be ridicule. What you're saying is basically what I'm trying to say is aimlessly making fun of people who are sacred to other people. For example, drawing a naked cartoon of Prophet Muhammad. I mean, people have the right to do that. I'm not saying you don't have the right to do that, right? But I'm saying it's not the right thing to do. Instead, maybe we can just ridicule the ideas that Prophet Muhammad brought. If you think they're that bad, it's okay to ridicule them instead of ridiculing the person behind those ideas. Because it doesn't serve any purpose. It doesn't bring peace to society, it doesn't bring harmony, as opposed to, let's say, if I don't like an idea about Islam and I was an atheist, I could discuss the idea about, you know, any idea. Do angels exist? Was Prophet Muhammad a true prophet? Are there apostasy laws? Are they Islamic? I mean, we could argue these ideas without ridiculing, just purposelessly or lampooning, you know, stuff without any, that doesn't serve any purpose.
What if somebody says that, let's say you lived in an atheistic country, right?
Right.
And I made it law that you can criticize atheism, but you can't ridicule atheism. It's now law, right? Uh-huh. I think in that point, it serves a purpose to ridicule atheism, just uh-huh. to serve, and the point of that would be to show that you can't put a law on not ridiculing atheism, right?
Uh-huh.
That, in that situation, I think ridicule could serve a purpose. You know, if I say like, hey, you can criticize ideas of, you know, atheists, but don't draw, I don't know, naked cartoons of
Dawkins,
for example, right? That's illegal now. I think in that situation, maybe you should start drawing naked cartoons of Richard Dawkins,
right?
At that point, I think ridiculing is a sign of protest, to show that, you know, you can't really put laws, you know, there's no way you could put a law on this. You know what I mean? I think it does. And in that situation, it might serve a purpose. What do you think?
I think. See, first of all, I'm totally against any kind of blasphemy law. You know, you can't use legal means to restrict people's freedom of speech and expression in any form or manner, right? So I completely disagree with any form of blasphemy laws. So if someone, for example, said that you didn't have the right to draw naked cartoons of Dawkins, I don't think I would draw naked cartoons of Dawkins, but I would definitely intellectually rebut Dawkins' ideas and show them inferior and show the atheist government or whatever that your sacred person has ideas which are, you know, which I can easily rebut and rebuff, and they don't hold any water.
Yeah, but you might not choose to do that, but I'm saying,
but if someone does that, they have the right to.
Yeah, but I'm saying not only they have the right to, but I think at the point when like a Christian government or a Muslim government or any kind of government, when they make ridicule illegal, I think at that time it's not just you have the right to it. I think at that point it actually makes sense to do it as well. You know, even ridicule and mockery, just because you could to basically show that this is not something you could regulate. I mean, even if I don't choose to do it myself,
right,
I could see the point behind somebody doing that. You know what I mean? At that point, you know, and also another point I say, like when we say we criticize ideas and not people, we have to understand, like Muhammad, for non-Muslims like me, it's now represents an idea. I mean, when we say we don't target individuals, we're talking about people alive today. You know, I'm not gonna discriminate against you. I disagree with Islam, but I shouldn't discriminate against you for being a Muslim, right? I'm just gonna tell you why I disagree with Islam. But I think that this not targeting people doesn't mean that I can't target, you know, people that have passed away or some people that might not have even existed or people that might have existed, but most of their lives, most of their stories for me might not even be true, you know. At that point, it's like me talking about, you know, fictional characters. I mean, I'm not saying Muhammad was a fictional character, but, you know, for me, it might be 80, like a lot of his story might be fiction. You know, I know a lot of his story for you might not be, but at the same, I'm just saying, like for us, Muhammad mostly represents his life, mostly represents the teaching of Islam and the belief. So criticizing him, especially since in Islam, everything that Muhammad does and everything that he says becomes Islamic teaching, right? So at that point, when I criticize Muhammad, I'm I'm criticizing an idea, not targeting an individual. You know what I mean?
So again, I you see, here's the thing. I think we're saying the same thing, but kind of different. Let me give you another example. I completely agree with you that you don't agree with Islam, and you can criticize Prophet Muhammad's ideas, I mean, as much as you want. The thing is, Islam places a lot of stress on mutual respect and not ridiculing others. It's actually clearly stated in the Quran that even if someone insults, actually it says that Muslims should not insult even idols. Yeah, I idolatry is one of the biggest sins in Islam, but even idols are, you know, Muslims are commanded not to insult them, because then the idolaters might insult Allah in return. Sorry?
Is this a Quran verse or a hadith?
Quranic verse. Yeah, it's a Quranic verse. I don't remember the reference on the top of my head, but I can look it up. I actually published an article on the Goodman project called Islam and Free Speech, Five Things You Should Know. And I detailed Islam's idea of free speech in that article in detail. But here's let me give you an analogy to try to explain what I'm trying to say. And this is nothing personal between us, but I'm giving you an example of, let's say your grandfather passed away. He's no longer alive, and he had some ideas which I did not like. Again, this is all hypothetical. Let's say he formed a community and he had some ideas, he wrote a book which I completely disagree with. Mm-hmm. The intellectual way to show that I don't agree with him, or I feel that his ideas are dangerous, is to rebut his ideas intellectually in the form of a book, to criticize them down and, to openly speak about them. That should be fine. But there's no reason that I should draw, for example, naked pictures of him. I don't think so. That serves any purpose at all. It only shows that I'm not elevating my free speech. Islam basically urges Muslims to elevate their free speech, to criticize ideas openly, but not to purposelessly ridicule someone. So, for example, if I did that in your case, more than likely you would not like what I do, and I don't think I'll be able to convince you of my argument anyway, because you'll be offended right in the start. I mean, I'm not opening up the door to dialogue here, because I'm starting the dialogue with something that's offensive to you. So I don't think I'll be able to convince you that your grandfather was wrong about his ideas if I started with that approach. That's all we're saying. Sure, I have the right to make the naked cartoon, but is that the right way to go, is the question here.
Well, to be fair, if you actually look at the history of comedy and the history of, people using satire and different methods of conveying ideas, it has been very effective, during the Cold War, during the Nazi period, World War II, so people have been able to shape and change ideas with comedy, with ridicule, with cartoons and newspaper, and it has at times been very effective. And the Draw Muhammad Day campaigns has I think been effective in, first of all, the reaction that some Muslims had to one cartoon, right? Remember, uh-huh. Now with the Draw Muhammad Day campaigns, now a lot of Muslims have become a little bit desensitized to it, and you don't get the same reaction to one cartoon as you used to get before, right?
That's
so
right.
A lot of Muslims that did have that heavy reaction now saw and see that it backfired, and so they see that that kind of anger and that kind of backlash usually doesn't work. So it was a, first of all, it was a lesson to them. Second, it also desensitized a lot of Muslims to Draw Muhammad, because now they're like, oh, these idiots are just drawing Muhammad again. So they don't get as angry as they used to get. Also, a lot of some Muslims that are in support of freedom of expression, like you, they became empowered to say, you know what, I'm not going to draw Muhammad, but these people should be able to. And they just, by them saying that out loud, they found each other. And now you have Muslim groups supporting freedom of speech. So in that sense, I think these drawing Muhammad cartoons really achieved their goals in so many levels, not only to, you know, fight against Muslims that are having such a negative reaction, but also to empower Muslims that are saying that I don't have a problem with this because I'm a Muslim. The rule is that I can draw Muhammad, but I don't think that this rule applies to non-Muslims. Like, how could I expect non-Muslims to follow Islam? This is a rule for Muslims, not a rule for non-Muslims, right? So, yep. And I think it started that conversation, and a lot of people that never knew what are the limits of freedom of speech or expression had to go read up once this issue was brought up because of the drawing Muhammad. They had to go read up on it. So a lot of people got educated over about freedom of expression and freedom of speech. So what do you think? Like, don't you think such it was like effective?
Again, it depends on what your end goal is. If, for example, I'm a Muslim, right? Yes. And if you're making, back to your point, satire, of course, can be constructive as well. And actually, I've written pieces that are satire as well, and I think it can be very constructive. But then there's a point where it becomes really meaningless. And the naked cartoons is specifically what I'm talking about. I'm talking about indecent cartoons. I'm not talking about regular cartoons or satirical pieces. What I'm talking about is where it becomes indecent. So there, it serves no purpose at all. So if the end goal is, for example, freedom of speech, that doesn't serve that purpose at all. For example, the N-word is something that's indecent to the African American population. Just because I want that N-word, I want the freedom to be able to use that N-word, doesn't mean I should just go about using it everywhere. That's not upholding free speech, that's just being indecent. And the same goes with the homophobia and sexism, and any kind of bigotry, anti-Semitism, for example. There are laws in Europe against anti-Semitic speech as well, which I oppose. I think there should be no legal.
Yeah, I oppose them as well. I mean, I think that bigotry should be legal. I mean, are we gonna homophobia? You know, you shouldn't be able to discriminate against people. Like, if you deny service to people because of for their sexual orientation or for their race. Right. You should, that's illegal, but you should be able to say whatever crazy thing you want to say. I think these, what you call indecent speech, also, I think it serves a purpose to push the limits of freedom of speech to the max. You know, for example, one group maybe that I think me and you could say that we are against is like the Westboro Baptist Church, right?
Uh-huh.
Right. I think it was, they served such a great purpose.
Which one again, sorry?
The Westboro Baptist Church people that are they go, okay, they say the most craziest thing, but they say like they are basically, for example, they go and they celebrate American soldiers dying, right? And they say thank God for dead soldiers and stuff like that, right? Whatever their views are or whatever, they just try to come up with the most offensive possible thing to say, and they go to places where they're not, welcome and say these things, right? And I think that's great because it shows that the United States is so free that Even insulting their most cherished icons is allowed. I think they basically working against themselves because they're trying to show how United States is such a bad place, but they're showing the world that there is no holy thing here that you could insult and go to jail for it, right?
That's right. Sure. And that's a good example, actually, that serves my purpose here. So what I'm saying is, first of all, they should be allowed to say what they're saying, right? The Westboro Church should be allowed to say whatever crazy thing they want to say. The mullahs in England, for example, some of them, like the Anjum Chaudhry types, right? They say crazy things as well. And they should be allowed to say whatever they want to say, as long as it's not insightful to violence. But that's not the question here of whether they should be allowed to say. We both agree that they should be allowed to be to say crazy things they want to. But let's take your own example of Westboro Church. How many people look favorably upon the Westboro Church or have respect for them? See, the thing is, it serves, even though they have the right to say what they're saying, but they're just seen as trolls. And that's what has become of the new atheist community as well. Sadly, you know, many people just see them as trolls, just because instead of elevating free speech and criticizing Islam, instead of using, you know, satire, they're just doing what the Westboro Church is doing, which is actually, you know, it's the same thing. And it's a good example you bring up, because it doesn't serve any purpose, is what I'm saying. We both agree that they should have the right to do that. But what I would rather have people do is come together like me and you are doing here and criticize Islam openly, criticize each other's ideas, have rational dialogue. And I think this is how we can, you know, we can improve the standards of free speech, rather than just, in, you know, insisting that free speech just means that we should have the right to just aimlessly or purposelessly just ridicule the other person's holy figures or ideas.
Well, not aimless. Here's the thing. I would not. I think, like, you know, a really disgusting image of Muhammad, I wouldn't go there, right? But I would support. I mean, I personally wouldn't go there, right? But I would like to see an image of Muhammad that, for me personally, that has a message, right? For example, a very beautiful image of Muhammad to say, like, to and post it and be like, how could anybody find this offensive, right? And it's something that some Muslims will find offensive because you're posting a picture of Muhammad, but at the same time, we're making a point. It has a message, you know? It's not aimless, as you say. It's showing that, look, this is a very, you know, an image of Muhammad is actually very, you know, so it's making a point at that point, right?
Yeah.
Or maybe something funny even that has a point, has a message, right? But at the same time, I would never, you know, draw, like, I saw an image of Muhammad that is clearly meant to be disgusting, right? But I mean, I would think, like, I didn't even like looking at it. It was that disgusting, right?
Exactly. That's what I'm talking about.
But the thing, okay, yeah, it's true that I would never draw that. And I personally don't, might not even like the person that draws that.
Mm-hmm.
And we would never post something like that on our platform. We would post a picture of Muhammad that has a good message in it, that we think it serves a purpose. But a disgusting image of like that, we would never post that. But at the same time, even though I don't really like that person, I'm glad that Westboro Baptist Church exists to exhibit that we have so much free speech in the United States these people can freely say whatever the hell they want. And I'm glad that that person is putting that out there to show that you can't remove even that disgusting image. You can't just get rid of that. You know, no matter how much people complain about it, that image is going to just stay there. I mean, I don't like it. I'm not going to look at it. I'm not going to post it anywhere. But I think you need to go. I mean, I think that image would serve no purpose if people were not trying to regulate content based on being offensive. The example that I like, if somebody comes and tells me, you know what, I find this offensive, right? I find this offensive. I'd be like, okay, well, I don't want you I don't want you to see it because I don't want to hurt your feelings, right?
No.
But if some person says, like, I find this offensive and it should not be made, still, I would be like, I'm going to ignore that person and I'm not going to try to push content out there for him to see. But if somebody all of a sudden says, I find this offensive, I think it should not be made, and he's also being successful at trying to get people to remove this content, then I would like, okay, we need to push this content as far as possible to show these people that they can't just use their personal feelings to control other people's content, you know? If somebody was just being offended,
right,
then it makes sense for us to try to not avoid making that person see this content. Why would we want to, like, we're not sadistic. We don't want to hurt people's feelings for no reason. Uh-huh. But if they try to regulate based on what they find offensive, then at that point, I think it's important for us to show that you can't regulate this kind of stuff. What do you think?
Sure. Let me give you, so you're saying you're not going to post that image, which is an extremely disgusting image of Prophet Muhammad, let's say, on your forum. So you're basically regulating your own forum, right? You're regulating content on your forum. You don't want some bad content on your forum, right?
Yes.
You are regulating content. That's, you're not allowing speech on your forum.
Okay, no. Okay. You can regulate your private forum website as much as you want. In fact, when we're talking about free speech, we're talking about government, right?
Correct.
I think you could go, you could even be completely more, you have much more regulations than that when it's your private forum. You could even be, if it's your website or your church or your mosque, you can be like, no criticism is allowed here. And that's completely okay. That's your private area. What I'm talking about is when you ask government regulations.
Oh, government regulations, we're both against. We already agreed on that.
Yes. No, so,
Oh, yeah. So I think a few things here. We basically agree that there should be no government regulation on free speech, which is why we also oppose the Holocaust laws in Europe. I think there should be no legal restriction on free speech. Restriction is bad. However, that said, I have a free speech right to oppose speech which I consider indecent. That's my free speech right. So, for example, if I consider something disgusting, like you said, if there was an image that was really obscene of Prophet Muhammad, which you would not post on your forum and would consider disgusting, then we both have our free speech right to say, hey, listen, this is really disgusting. I don't think so. This is decent enough for my forum. I wouldn't go out of the way. The difference between me and you is we both consider that image disgusting, but you're saying, oh, you know what? I have to promote it now in order to make a point for free speech, while I believe that I should not give platforms to bigots. Bigots have the right to be bigots. Remember that. The Westboro Church has the right to be to do what they do. Mullahs in the Muslim world have the right to be bigots. But I have homophobes. There are many homophobes in the U.S. as well. They have the right to be homophobes. But the problem is, should I give them the platform to express their homophobia, to express their bigotry? That is the issue. Government should not regulate it. But I would not go out of the way to give them that platform. I would never do that. So I don't consider this a win for free speech. I would consider this a win for bigotry. In my opinion, free speech is elevated when it's elevated in terms of standards, when it's also more decent, it serves a purpose of bringing us together, like it's bringing together me and you right now. I mean, if you were making an indecent cartoon of Prophet Muhammad, we would not be having this conversation. I would not stop you from making it, but I would of course not want to have a conversation with someone who doesn't, you know, who is starting a conversation that serves no purpose at all. And same for you. If I came here with a cartoon of, let's say, your grandfather, which was indecent, I don't think we'll be having this rational dialogue here.
I would be more interested in talking. I actually, I'm gonna reach out to people. I don't know, because first of all, there's a lot of different things going on here. First of all, I don't think, you know, even if I disagree, okay, if somebody draws a Muhammad that is not disgusting, I think they're doing a good job, right? And I would promote that. If somebody is drawing a disgusting cartoon of Muhammad, I wouldn't promote that. I would not promote that, but I'm glad that it exists. Even though I don't like the person that made it, I'm glad it exists because it shows that these things are there and you can't get rid of it, right? But at the same time, I don't know if that person is a bigot necessarily. It might be a bigot, might not be a bigot, because he might, you know, I think the person that is drawing a beautiful image of Muhammad is more effective because it's showing like, hey, look, I'm not even, this shouldn't even be offensive. And people are trying to take it off. I think that person is being more effective. So I like that person's fight for free speech more. But at the same time, that person that I drew a disgusting image of Muhammad, I think he or she is being less effective But at the same time, I'm not sure if he's a bigot. Maybe he or she is just fighting for freedom of speech, but maybe not in a very nice way, right? So not, I wouldn't necessarily say he might, maybe, okay, we can't assume people's motivations. Maybe she thinks that this is a good way to fight for freedom of speech. Uh-huh. Maybe she's just sadistic and just enjoys seeing Muslims get angry.
Right.
Or maybe she is a bigot against people from other countries, and she's just masking her bigotry with criticism of Islam, right? Uh-huh. But I can't assume. I don't know, you know, necessarily if she's a bigot or not.
Of course.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm just saying, like, people that criticize Islam in a wrong way are not necessarily bigots. Uh-huh. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, I don't think so. I don't think so. If you're criticizing Islam by criticizing the ideas of Islam, I don't think so. There's any wrong way. You can criticize whatever you want to do. In the end, we can always agree to disagree, right? Someone can, for example, I've had debates with atheists on apostasy laws, on blasphemy laws, and in the end, you know, some of them agree, some of them just say, oh, you know what, ISIS is right about Islam and you're wrong. I'm sorry. And we can always agree to disagree. I don't think there's a wrong way as long as it's dialogue. But here's the thing, we are all different, right? We all come from different cultural backgrounds. We all come from different socioeconomic backgrounds, geopolitical backgrounds. And so, for example, let's say in my own understanding and vision of the world, it was extremely hurtful to draw my mother. And, you know, and you wouldn't, I don't think it would be wise for you to draw, you would still have the right to draw my mother, but I don't think it would be right for you to draw my mother just to make a point like, okay, this guy thinks that it's bad to draw his mother. Now I think it's a great idea to draw his mother, and I'm going to shove his mother's image all over the internet, over all the people that belong to his cultural background. I don't think that serves any purpose, but yeah, go ahead. Sorry.
No, go on. Sorry, I don't want to interrupt.
Yeah. So I don't think it serves any purpose in that case. So whereas I believe that some of these people who are drawing cartoons might not be bigots necessarily, and I think they should have the right to draw whatever they're drawing. I'm not saying that they should not have the right to do so. I'm just saying we should be respectful of other people's visions, and we should respect the idea and the fact that we're all different people. We come from different backgrounds. We have different different visions of the world, and you know, we get offended by different things than each other. So even though we might not we might not understand each other's vision of the world, we should still respect that difference there. Yeah, the same comes. The same is true for any other kind of speech, like be it homophobia, sexism, or anti-Semitism. I think people should be free to say whatever they want to say, but we should. What I believe is not a legal construct of free speech, but a sociocentric model of free speech. And I've explained that in my article as well. But what I mean by that is society should determine what speech is helpful and which is not. So, and we do a good job at that already. I mean, think about it. The N-word. Just say it anywhere, and you're going to be on the media the next day, right? You'll probably be fired from your work. Say anything anti-Semitic, and you'll also probably be fired from your work, and you'll be you'll be on the media if you're a famous person. So we already do a good job in terms of the society regulating free speech on its own. I don't think it should be regulated at the government level, but at the social level, I think we already do a good job. It's just that we in this particular case, I think we're forgetting to understand the mindset of Muslims in this regard.
Yeah. Okay. So just to be clear, what we agree on and where the disagreement is. So our agreement is on the side that government should not tell us what to say and what not to say, right?
Correct.
But
correct.
I think the disagreement that we have is whether offending a certain view, personal view, could be effective. Is it the right thing to do or not the right thing to do at some points, right? And going correct. By your example, right, if I say, you know, please don't draw a cartoon of my father making fun of him, he passed away last year, this uh-huh. is kind of hurts my feelings, right? Don't do uh-huh. that, right?
Yep.
It makes sense for you to at that point not to do that.
Right.
And but then all of a sudden, if I have friends in the government, right, or uh-huh. if I go there and say like, or you know, or in the media and everywhere, and try to like, you know what, I want, my father was such a great person, right? I want to make it illegal for people to draw his cartoon.
I would oppose that.
You would oppose that, but I think at that point it's actually effective to start drawing his cartoon.
It's not your fault.
No.
See, here's the thing. We should criticize the government for regulating our speech. Not me. No. My father should not be. See, I would still not draw your father because it's not affecting the government. It's affecting you personally. What I would do is I would take on the media. I would write about the government. I would criticize them openly. I would just demolish the blasphemy laws. And actually, we do a good job at that ideologically. I've written extensively on the blasphemy laws, and my community, other members from my community have done that as well. We oppose Pakistan's blasphemy laws, Saudi Arabia's blasphemy laws openly. We think it's counterproductive to have blasphemy laws.
But here's the thing, though. People have been writing about freedom of speech for thousands of years, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But demonstrating something sometimes is very effective rather than just intellectually talking about it. Most people don't read long articles or, you know, books about, you know, what is your right and, you know, freedom of speech and stuff like that. They don't, right? And they don't watch long YouTube discussions about people fighting about these things, right? But I think if I go out of my way to try to make it illegal for you to draw my father, right? Uh-huh. If I'm campaigning and I have so many people supporting me and the government is backing me up on that, I think it's not only effective, but I think it could be an obligation for people to start drawing my father, right? Because
do you think it's an obligation
for some people at some point? So they have to, yeah, I think so. Because at that point, you know, I'm not saying don't, if you don't want to draw my father, I don't think some people should at some point, right? Not everybody, right? But I think, yes, if you don't like to draw my father, don't. You go write your articles about why it shouldn't be illegal. You go to your TV interviews and discuss people why this law is stupid. But I think at the same time, for some people to bring attention to this, you know, especially when it's being ignored, at that point, people should draw my father and put it everywhere. As much as possible, not on my private place. Like they're not allowed to come to my home, which is my private area, or my website that I have regulations for, or my mosque or my church. Those private areas where I can choose what content I'm exposed to, they have no right to show me the content there. But they could go on their Facebook pages, on their websites, on their public billboards, and they put my, I think it's a good idea at that point to put my father's picture everywhere. Because especially if your articles and your books and your campaign is not working, at you know, maybe you could try your methods first, but if it's not getting attention and I'm getting my way, at that point people need to go out and show that this law is stupid. So we need to show you that you can't regulate this, and they should put my father's picture everywhere at that point. But if you know, if I wasn't trying to regulate this, if I wasn't trying to force this on people, it would be a bad idea to draw my father. You know, it wouldn't be nice. If I was just asking you, like, hey, I don't like this, please don't show this to me, then why would I do that? That would be sadistic to do that at that point, right? But
okay. But
if I'm getting my way to make this law, I think at that point it makes sense to start drawing my, you know.
Sure.
What I mean?
2 points there. And I have two counter questions for you on what you've just said. The first is, I am a Muslim living in the United States. There's no prohibition here for you to draw cartoons, right? If you really want to show that the government of Saudi Arabia, Pakistan, or Iran are wrong in the blasphemy laws, I think you ought to take this up with the governments there. I mean, in America, I'm not doing anything. I'm actually giving you the, I actually think, so I'm one of those Muslims who's, for example, saying, hey, Armin, listen, see, I respect Prophet Muhammad like my father, right? Mm-hmm. Even more maybe for some Muslims. And so I would really like you not to make an obscene picture of him. I think if you listen to me, it would just increase the understanding we have for each other, the mutual respect we have for each other, mm-hmm. and it would not be hurtful at all. I mean, the government of the USA has no regulations against. So you're making no point here by making a cartoon against Prophet Muhammad or an obscene cartoon of Prophet Muhammad in America. There's no point you're making to the government here. Secondly, do you feel the same kind of obligation about anti-Semitic speech in Europe? So, for example, do you have the same kind of passionate, feeling for people, or do you urge people to be openly anti-Semitic in Europe to fight the anti-Semitic laws? Do you feel that way as well?
All right, which one do you want me to respond to first?
Both, either way.
All right, so for the US, I'm actually, first of all, a Facebook page is international. So we are fighting for the people in Iran, in Saudi Arabia, and Pakistan, especially because they don't get to be free and say whatever they want. They live in danger. We have to use our freedom here to be their voices, right? We are lucky enough to be able to express their views. So we're not fighting for change in Canada or United States or Europe. We're fighting for, you know, everybody that is being oppressed. We are trying to fight for the ex-Muslims and atheists in Iran and Pakistan and Saudi Arabia, right? The thing is that when you post this on Facebook page, we're not posting it in the United States. The Facebook page is accessible everywhere, right? Uh-huh. Secondly, we have to remember that every liberty that we fought for and we managed to gain doesn't mean that because we had that victory, it doesn't mean that it's guaranteed to stay there, right? You have to, when you fought for and won it, you have to fight for keeping it. You know, there are so many examples of governments gaining freedom and within really quickly within government changes and supports, you know, government using fear tactics and taking freedoms away really fast. They're, you know, going the opposite way. And people like you and me that are on side of the freedom of speech and expression, even in countries that it has become free, we should always continue making that point and driving that point home to make sure it stays there and doesn't go the other way around, right? Like, you look, there are countries that are reintroducing ways to discriminate against people, or, you know, and limit freedom of speech. So it's not a one-way battle. With regards to anti-Semitism, okay, here's the thing. There's two different things here, right? First of all, do I support is the ideas that I think that are correct and are being oppressed, are being silenced, and ideas that I think are wrong and are being oppressed, as are being silenced, right? So for any idea that I think is, for both ideas that are wrong and, in my opinion, right, I think none of them should be silenced. So, for example, so criticizing Islam, I think Islam is not correct. So criticizing Islam, I think it's, sometimes like the criticism of Islam that I've seen, and some of them are good, some of them are bad. So I support that passionately, right? If you want to regulate that, I'm very passionate about not putting content out there that is criticism of Islam, so to show you that you shouldn't be able to silence that. Ideas that I disagree with, for example, anti-Semitism, the thing is that I'm against silencing them, but I don't want to put anti-Semitic content out there myself, right? Why? Because I don't agree with that, you know? So, but I will fight for the right of everybody to say whatever they want. But I myself, I'm not going to say something. How could I say something that I don't believe in? How could I fight for something?
Would
that
you be
I don't
glad
believe?
That there are anti-Semitic people out there?
No,
who are using their.
Oh, no. I'm not glad that they're anti-Semitic. And I think that they should. In fact, being able to, but I'm glad if they're free to express themselves, I'm glad that they're free to express themselves, right? I'm not glad that they exist, But I'm glad that they can express themselves. And especially, I think, fighting some of these bad ideas for that to happen is important for them to be able to express themselves, or else most people wouldn't even know that this is a major problem, right? I think if you drive some of these ideas underground, they grow faster, they feel like they're victims, so they become, you know, that empowers them. And also a lot of people that are not aware about how, I'm not anti-Semitic, or some, like, let's say, I don't know how big this problem is in Europe. I'm just using it as an example. Let's say it's a huge problem, right? Let's say anti-Semitism is huge, right? But most people wouldn't know that it's a huge problem if you silence them. You know what I mean? So I think if bad ideas should be freely expressed, so that we know that they exist, and we could try to fix this problem by educating people, not by silencing people, right? Sure. You know, but when it comes to bad ideas being freely expressed, I think the response to that should be education, and good ideas being silenced, the response to that should be promotion of those ideas.
Right. That's what and you just agreed that, just like anti-Semitism, drawing obscene cartoons, very obscene, which you find disgusting yourself, is a bad idea, right?
It's a bad idea. Depends on the. Well, okay. First of all, it depends on the motive of the person that is drawing it. I think it's not as effective as drawing a good, beautiful picture of Muhammad to show that, wow, some people are finding this offensive as well. So yeah, I think it's not effective, as effective. But it's interesting because I think the cartoons of Muhammad that are not disgusting, I see that they get more of a reaction than really disgusting cartoons of Muhammad, because they're just dismissed as just crazy people. But you know, but anyways, but go
right,
on.
But I think Armin, and also just on the same point, you know, many Muslims, and I always preach this and teach this whenever I write or talk to people or assemblies, that in Islam, the response to whatever kind of ridicule, however bad it is actually the opposite of what we see, unfortunately, in parts of the Muslim world. I mean, people sometimes take to the streets and cause violence. I'm sure you've seen that happen in parts of the Muslim world. But the Quran says the exact opposite. The Quran says, when the ignorant address you, just say to them, peace, and that's it, and move on. And it's very unfortunate that we don't see that. And another verse in the Quran, it says, and people will mock you, and know that Allah is sufficient for you, which means that the only teaching of Islam in these kind of situations is just to ignore and move on, not to obsess over it or cause anger to take over.
Do you also believe in hadith, other than the Quran?
I believe in hadith, but we interpret hadith, Quran, because Quran, of course, we consider the word of God, but hadith, we know have been collected hundreds, or in some cases, you know, centuries after Prophet Muhammad passed away. So we always evaluate them in a very scientific method, where the first standard is always the Quran. That's the gold standard. And then we look at the hadith, we look at the narrations, the chain of narrators, we look at the message itself and see whether it goes in line with the message of the Quran and with other established practice of the Prophet Muhammad.
Yeah, there's a very standard process about how people figure out what's authentic hadith. And they're based on that process. There's been six books with Sunni, so those are authentic hadiths, right? So you consider those books?
No. And that's not the method we use. So what, like I said, the gold standard is the Quran. There are many hadiths in Bukhari. Bukhari is one of the most authentic hadith books, according to Sunni.
So you don't believe in Bukhari?
No. That's what I was trying to say, that we believe in all these hadith books, but we don't believe in individual hadiths as such. We don't say, oh, this was in Bukhari, so it must be true. What we say is, oh, this is more authentic than others, but we still have to evaluate it and compare it to the Quran. There are many hadiths in Bukhari which I don't consider true. And
Okay, but you do agree that most Muslims consider these six books authentic hadiths, and you agree that most Islamic law and teaching, maybe not with you and other Ahmadi Muslims, but most Muslims, their teachings and their rules comes more from hadith than it comes from the Quran.
I don't know if it's more from the hadith, but a lot of influence of Sunni Islam comes from the six books of hadith, and that's true for Ahmadiyya Islam as well. Except that, like I said, we have a different methodology. Our methodology is not Bukhari, so it must be true. Our methodology is Quran is supreme, and everything has to be measured with that yardstick, which is the Quran.
Yeah, but the thing is that the Quran really doesn't have that much rules in there, right? It's as much as hadith does, right? There's way more hadith about how you're supposed to live your life and what you're supposed to do than the Quran, right? And that's why if you look at, I mean, I don't know how it is with the Ahmadi Muslims, but if you look at Islamic, all the writings on Islamic law and Islamic, Sharia law, or just daily advice on how you're supposed to live your life, the majority of it comes from hadith, both with Shias, I mean, the 12 Shias and the Sunnis, and both Shias and Sunnis have books in hadith, Islamic hadith, that they consider authentic. And when they say authentic, they mean as authoritative as the Quran, because the Quran itself says that you should use Muhammad and his way of life as a model. So
that's right.
So because of
So I also believe that we should take Prophet Muhammad's life as an example. The only problem is, how do you know that hadith collected 200 years later was actually his word? That is where we differ. We don't differ in the fact that we both believe, Sunnis and Ahmadis, that Prophet Muhammad's life was exemplary and we should follow that example. The only difference is whether a certain hadith was actually his word or not. I mean, we can't just blindly follow something as his word when we know that these hadiths were collected centuries later. We know that some of them might be authentic, might not be authentic, and while a majority of them are authentic. So we have to, we always, for example, I give you a simple example. The Quran is against apostasy laws, for example. It says very, very clearly, it upholds freedom of conscience. It says, let him who will believe and let him who will disbelieve. It says clearly that the Prophet Muhammad's task was to deliver the message, not to impose it.
But the context, of that verse, when that verse came to Muhammad, when he was in Mecca, right?
Which one? The one which says there's no compulsion in religion.
Yes.
Yes.
That was when the Quraysh, correct me if I'm wrong, is that when the Quraysh were telling him to accept his gods? Accept the Quraysh gods?
I'm not sure. I can look into that. I'm not sure exactly when that was revealed.
Because I remember, if I remember correctly, actually, I don't want to get... Okay, we could get into this because I have... There's a lot of things that I want to address, but I'm just trying to pick and choose. Right. But the when Muhammad was in Mecca, he was telling people that, don't force your religion to each their own religion. That means don't force your idol worship on us. Let us be Muslim, right? But then when he went to Medina and then he became powerful, then he was like, Islam is the religion,
I don't agree with that, actually. I because here's the thing. First of all, I can check when that verse was revealed, but we believe, all Muslims believe, that the Quran is the word of God in its entirety. We don't believe any verse of the Quran is abrogated or applied to one phase and not the other, except, of course, for certain...
But doesn't the Quran itself say that God can change his rules?
I know the verse you're talking about, but there's not a single Muslim you will find in the world, not a single out of 1.6 billion who believe that any verse of the Quran, any one verse of the Quran is abrogated. This is a belief that I find, I hear from new atheists or I hear from right-wing Christians, but this is, there's no Muslim who believes any one verse of the Quran is abrogated or doesn't, or not effective.
That is, so coming, well, I know Muslims that believe that.
That I mean, believe that verses of the Quran are abrogated?
If you mean by abrogated, if you mean that the verse is useless, that's yep. not what they mean by that. But I do believe that, I had Muslim teachers that in Iran that taught me that this verse was only for a specific time and then another verse. Yeah, came. So that's what they mean by abrogated. It doesn't mean when they say abrogated, it doesn't mean that this verse is now completely useless. It's clearly has a message or so you could learn something from it. But
that it was from a certain time.
Yes, yes. That's what they mean by abrogated.
Right. For example, the verses that relate to the Battle of Badr, the historical verses, which many people try to apply for all times, including ISIS. But yeah, I agree. There are certain verses that apply to certain times. For example,
then you believe in abrogation as well, then?
No, actually, we don't believe in abrogation. We just believe that there are certain verses which apply to certain times. But that's not the meaning of abrogation. When you say abrogation, that means that they are verses that that are useless, basically. They're not part of the Quran. They're like God said, oh, okay, I'm sorry, this verse is not part of the Quran. Actually, we believe every verse is sacred, and yes, every verse has to be interpreted with wisdom, because the Quran itself says there are some verses in the Quran which are literal, and there are other verses in the Quran which are metaphorical. This is said in the third chapter of the Quran. In the start of it, there's a verse that says this very clearly.
Yes, I read that verse, which makes it very strange for me because, then how am I supposed to know which one of these are metaphor and which one of them are?
That's interesting, and that's when we talk about each of these topics separately, we can bring up and discuss. I think it's very easy to find out, but again, it's when you use the you know. Proper scholarly methodology to look at these verses. But again, I think coming back to your point about freedom of religion, like I said, in the Quran, there is not a single verse that says anything about apostasy laws. And actually, there's 12 times in the Quran that apostates are mentioned.
There's hadith that is about apostasy.
And there is a hadith. I'll talk about that too if you want. But Bukhari first of all, we have to... Was that?
It was a Bukhari hadith too.
It was a Bukhari hadith. Yes, I know.
That says Muhammad says you could kill Muslims are supposed to be killed only in three. There's three situations that you can kill, and one of them is when they leave Islam. Yeah, apostate. Most Muslims, I mean, I know Ahmadi. Maybe you don't agree with that hadith, no, but most Muslims believe that that's authentic hadith.
So I agree with that hadith, but here's the problem. The thing is, like I said, there's a methodology to understanding Islam. You know, like I'm a doctor, right? And your father is a doctor. When we evaluate medical evidence, we go from the strongest evidence, which is a randomized controlled trial, and the weakest kind of evidence is a case study. And the same is true for religion as well. First of all, we see what the Quran says, and the Quran says, La ikraha fi din, there's no compulsion in religion. And it says, let him who will believe, and let him who will disbelieve. And it's not speak about apostates. It speaks about apostates 12 times. And each of these times, I mean, it never says, oh, you know what, kill them or punish them in any other way. So in one verse, for example, it says, and when they turn back, remember that your task was only to deliver the message. Oh, that's all. If people turn back from Islam, mm-hmm.
Those verses are not about apostates. Those verses are about people that are ignoring his message. I mean, I don't.
No.
I mean, they're verses.
I'll quote one verse, for example. It says, "Those who believe, and then disbelieve, and then believe,
yes,
and then disbelieve."
Said, okay, those are the two-faced people. What does he call them?
Hypocrites.
Hypocrites. Yes, the hypocrites.
No, but if you believe and disbelieve, that's apostasy.
Yeah, but the Quran makes it seem like they were never part of your camp. They were just they were basically just joined you because like they just wanted support, you know, like if you read their.
You can call them hypocrites, but anyone by definition who disbelieves after believing is a same in another verse, and there are 12 verses, and I can, if you want, I can leave a link to my article on apostasy as well, but there's another verse that says, and those who turn back after believing in you, remember that your task was only the delivery of the message. So what that means is those who apostatize after Prophet Muhammad was not supposed to do anything. You punish them in any way, let alone death. And you know, I've debated, I don't know if you know Ali Amjad Rizvi, he's also an atheist blogger. And I debated him on a Huffington Post, and you know, people can look up my debate with him.
Yeah. Just to tell people that all your articles will be this is going to be on YouTube, and I'm going to link to your articles in the description of this video. So
Thank you. So yeah, in that debate, you know, I proved that from the Quran upholds freedom of conscience in clear terms. And it's not that I debate these issues only with people who are critics of Islam. I've welcomed people in the Muslim world to debate with me as well. And they're, you know, they can't debate these issues because they know very well that the Quran does not support their version at all. Their insecurity about Islam is their personal insecurity. It's not based in Islam. And you mentioned this hadith. So let me come to that as well. The hadith that said that are three people that could be killed. One of them is those who leave Islam. Again, first of all, the primary message, the primary source of Islamic jurisprudence is the Quran. And that is clear. There's freedom of conscience at all costs. The hadiths have to be interpreted in whatever context they were said in. And again, remember, these were narrated 200 years later, so we don't know what the exact words were. And in this particular hadith, what we believe is this is a mention, or this hints towards treason at times of war. So when it is said that people who leave Islam, it's not meant in the sense that people who leave the religion of Islam, but because in that age, remember, there was war, and war was thrusted on Islam from all different corners. So those who left Islam in the sense that they left the camp of Islam while at war with other groups, this was mentioned for those particular people because this was treason. And the punishment for treason is death even today. So this did not refer to leaving.
Okay, first of all, it doesn't make, if you read the hadith, it doesn't make that clear. This is what we're assuming.
That's what I'm saying. The Quran makes it very clear. The hadith just says leaves Islam. I agree with you.
Okay, so the hadith doesn't clarify that this is based on treason. One thing I just want to point out about Islam, but people say when they try to say like this part is religion, this part is politics. If you study Islam, the line is very blur between when politics starts and when religion ends. Because we could actually get to that, because you actually believe religion and politics needs to be separate. But so many people argue that Islam is actually a very political religion, and there's no way you can separate the two.
But
regards to, so do you think that you say even today the punishment for treason is death? Do you think that's okay?
No. I'm just saying it is. I don't know if it's okay or not. That's a different debate.
Let's say it was just for treason.
Yeah.
Right? Do you think the punishment for treason should be death? Do you think it's okay to kill people for treason?
So first of all, the punishment for military treason, even in the USA, is death.
And should it be?
I don't know. That's a different debate. Whether that's the correct punishment for such a big crime can be debated. I'm not sure. But certainly, if that is the punishment 1,400 years later in a country like the United States, it's something that's up for debate. It's not something you can clearly disregard and say, oh, this is wrong. It's clearly something that's up for debate.
Okay. With regards to the hadith, right? So the way you interpret hadith and the way you consider which hadith is authentic is different from all four Sunni schools of law, Islamic thought, right? The four schools of Islam, Sunnis, right? And also the 12 Shias, which is the majority of Shias, they all of these teach that the punishment for apostasy should be death, right? Do you agree with that? I mean, you say this is not true Islam, yeah. right? But you agree that all four, from the Sunni side, all the four schools of Islamic thought teach that the punishment.
Yeah, I think if I'm not wrong, they teach that apostasy is punishable by death for a man, and they have an exemption for a woman, and a few other exemptions. But generally speaking, you're right. Generally speaking, the teaching of traditional Sunni Islam, of course, I have a lot of Sunni friends who disagree with that as well. But if you talk about the clergy, I agree with you that most of them do believe that apostasy is punishable by death.
Yeah.
Or many of them at least do. At least in Pakistan, the majority do.
Yeah. And in Egypt also.
Yeah, probably Egypt too. I wouldn't be surprised.
Okay, but so some people would say, like, okay, you're telling atheists like me that we shouldn't interpret Islam like that, and this is not the right way of looking at Islam. But then we have the majority of the Muslim world interpreting Islam like that. So I have a lot of people tell me, lot of liberal Muslims, right? They tell me, who the hell do you think you are to say what true Islam is, right? But then I sometimes ask them, well, who do they think they are to say what true Islam is? Because most Muslims disagree with them. I mean, most Muslims, so most Muslims would disagree with you about what is the you know, apostasy law, right? Apostasy law, right? So
I agree.
So what makes you think that, go.
Right. So here's the thing. See, I didn't use the term true Islam, but I definitely define every Muslim believes that, or at least if they're consciously believing in Islam, at least they believe that they're following what is true Islam, right? What the true teachings of Islam are. So how do we know? Intellectually speaking, on a scholarly level, Islam is defined by the Quran and by the established practice of Prophet Muhammad, not by what an Egyptian or Pakistani cleric says. So however much a Pakistani cleric wants to believe that there are apostasy laws in Islam, if the Quran says no, then that is it. And that is why, here's the thing, that is why Prophet Muhammad prophesies that in this age, when there would be nothing of Islam except its name, a reformer would appear to reform Islam. The reason for that reform was exactly this, that the clergy would have been corrupted. They would believe in things that are not Islamic at all. And he would bring these teachings back to them and teach them the true Quran. And so when I say I believe in something as Islamic, I don't say it because I believe in it blindly. I give you the scholarly evidence of that from the book that I believe is the Word of God. I will never say, for example, that, you know, apostasy laws are not correct because my religious leader said so. It's because the Quran said so. And I invite any Sunni cleric, any Shia cleric, anyone who believes that apostasy laws are Islamic to come and debate us. The founder of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, Mirza Ghulam Ahmed, has written extensively in this regard. And the fourth Khalifa, right now we have the fifth Khalifa, but the fourth Khalifa of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community wrote a whole book called Murder in the Name of Allah. It's an extensive book, and it covers this topic in extensive scholarly detail, and it rebuts the major, the main clerics that believed that apostasy was punishable by death. For example, you might have heard of Maududi, Abul Ata Maududi, right? He's a famous Pakistani cleric who formed Jamaat-e-Islami. So this book actually is a great rebuttal of his stance on apostasy as well. So true Islam, I wouldn't use the word true Islam, but yes, if you want to study Islam, then the criteria are simple. One, the word of the Quran, and two, it's the established teachings of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him.
But okay, the thing is, though, we have the same thing in Christianity and in Islam. People look at the same verse and they come up with different meanings, and they say, like, they have scholarly reason for it. But when some people look at it more honestly, you can say, you can see that this is vague enough for you to get anything you want out of it, right? The thing is that even let's say, okay, you have to really understand the message of the Quran or which hadith is true hadith and which hadith is not true hadith. You're saying that you need to do scholarly analysis.
That's right.
But wouldn't you, why would you think that the message, like God in his great wisdom, would communicate in such a way that was supposed to be for all people at all times, whether educated, non-educated, scholar, non-scholar, that uh-huh. you need to have a linguistic degree and a history degree and like to be able to decipher all these messages, and even with all this background and people being years of expertise in these, they don't seem to agree on any of this with each other. Don't you think that whoever wrote this message was a failure at communication?
I don't think so, and here's why. See, I don't have any degree in linguistics. I don't have any degree in history. When I say a scholarly interpretation, I just mean common sense scholarly interpretation. For example, the Quran is the word of God. And if you tell me that the hadith should be taken superior to the Quran, that's not scholarly at all. And that's what I mean by scholarly way to understand Islam. As far as the Quran is concerned, of course, there are people who differ in interpretation of various verses. And I think that's good. I think difference of interpretation is okay. It should be, it actually means that it actually leads to healthy debate as well. And that is why we have different sects in Islam, because many different sects interpret different verses in different ways. But the difference of interpretation is different from misinterpretation. For example, when people say that apostasy laws are Islamic, it's simple. Just ask them where in the Quran it says so. You will never be able to have, you'll never get any answer. There's no verse of the Quran that shows that.
You mentioned the Quran, but this is, we already established that this is not in the Quran, this is in the Hadith, right? And the disagreement is whether what the Hadith really meant, right?
So, and when the Hadith and Quran clash, we go by the Quran, which is the word of God. If the Quran says that apostasy is not punishable, there's freedom of conscience. Let him who will believe and let him who will disbelieve. We have to look at the context of the Hadith, which appears to contradict the Quran. And actually, I could have thrown it away saying, oh, you know, this is contradictory, it's just rubbish. But when you study the context, you find out it's a military context.
But
it's
that's not really a contradiction, though, because even if that verse was not abrogated by the Medina verses later, you could still let people believe what they want and, you know, oppress them for believing what they believe in. You know what I mean?
No, I think there's a contradiction there.
Well, okay, if there's a contradiction, do you believe that the Quran teaches that non-Muslims go to hell?
Not at all. Here's what the Quran says.
The Quran doesn't teach that non-Muslims, that only Muslims go to hell? To heaven?
Not at all. Not at all. Christians and even atheists will go to heaven. And this is why I base it on the Quran as well. In chapter 2 of the Quran, there's a verse in which Christians and Jews are mentioned. And it is said, the verse says, and the Christians and the Jews say that they are the only ones who will go to heaven. And in the next verse, and I did the exact wording, I'm just paraphrasing here, but the next verse says they are wrong. Who gave them the guarantee that only they will go to heaven? And it says whoever believes in God, whoever does good deeds, will go to heaven. And it mentions Christians, Jews, Sabians, etc. in that one verse.
But in that context, Islam, you know that Quran considers the true version.
I'm sorry, say that again.
But in that, you do know that the Quran considers the true version of Christianity to be Islam as well, and the true version of Judaism to be Islam as well, right? And the Quran also considers the true version of all religions to be Islam. Islam didn't start, according to the Quran, Islam did not start with Muhammad. Islam started with Adam, right? Because here's the thing, because when what the Quran teaches is that the Bible and the Torah, these were God's words, but they changed it, right? So they everything so these were used to be true religions, right? But it makes it clear that if you believe in the wrong version of Christianity, which is actually the most common Christianity today, you go to hell. It says if you believe, like, if you believe, according to the Quran, if you believe that Jesus is the Son of God,
Trinity,
yeah, you go to hell, which is basically, if, like, most Christians believe in the Trinity.
Sure.
Right? If you believe, does the Quran teach that if you believe in the Trinity, you go to hell or not?
Yes. So the Quran makes it clear that Islam, as you're saying, you know, you're saying the Quran is that Islam was a religion that was present even before Prophet Muhammad. There are two different things there. If you're saying Islam as in the fact that submitting to the will of God, then of course every religion taught submitting to the will of God. And even Prophet Abraham is called a Muslim in the Quran in that context. He submitted completely to the will of God. Mm-hmm. And so they're not Muslim in the sense of Muslim, but Muslim in the sense that all religions preach that we should submit to the will of God. And and the Quran also says that amongst Jews and Christians, there are good people who will go to heaven. Partners with God, associating partners with God, as you rightly mentioned, is a sin in Islam. And there are many sins that God has enumerated in the Quran and said that people who you know, act in this particular way would not go to heaven. But that includes, for example, not feeding the hungry people. That includes, for example, stealing, murder, and all evils. And of course, associating partners with God is also one evil mentioned in that same list. But also, you know, you should bear in mind that whereas that this is true, that considering anyone the Son of God is a sin in Islam, and we believe that Jesus never said that he was the Son of God, the Quran also mentions that God is all forgiving and merciful. So people, and his mercy overbounds his...
But he also says that if you believe in the Trinity, you go to the ever, you burn in hell forever.
Correct, right? It does. Yep.
Okay, so if it does teach that, it basically, and it also says to each person their own religion, and if this is not a contradiction, that you could believe in whatever you want, but if you believe in this, you go to hell forever. If that's not a contradiction, then at the same time saying you could believe in whatever you want, but we'll oppress the hell out of Hindus or idol worshippers, or then that's also not a contradiction. You could say,
I disagree with you, and this is why. See, God has given man free will on earth. When you say apostasy laws, we're talking about human punishment for anything, right? For example, let's take your example, Armin. So God, for example, in my vision of the cosmos and of our purpose on earth here, I believe that God created this universe. And I believe that my purpose on earth is to serve God and serve humanity. And that's why I'm created. And that's the message of the Quran. Now, you have the right not to believe in my version of my vision of the world. I have no right to punish you for that. Actually, I will be punished if I take away your free will, because free will, according to God in the earth, is very sacred to him. He's actually mentioned this clearly in one verse where he says, if he had willed, everyone on earth would have believed, but he did not want to, because he wanted everyone to have free will and to come to the conclusions that made sense to them. So on earth, there's free will in Islam. There's no one. I cannot force any Christian who believes in Trinity to, I can't punish them in any way. In fact, what God commands me or requires me to do is to love them, to teach them. And that's all, nothing. I love them the same way as I love Muslims. And if it comes to hell, remember, there are numerous categories of people that God says will go to hell. And these people include Muslims. You know, those people,
but that doesn't make burning somebody for what they believe in for eternity okay, just because there's going to be other bad people next to you.
Do you believe in the hell and heaven that the Quran teaches?
No, but
there's no reason to fear that. Then here's the thing.
No, I don't fear it. I'm just saying that it's like I'm just pointing out to something that I think it's a bad teaching. Not just because I don't believe in it doesn't mean that it's not wrong. I mean, yeah. I could actually if I'm trying to show somebody that why this book is wrong.
Yeah.
I could point out to the fact that it's telling you that somebody that believes in a specific thing should be burned forever. Right. Even if I don't believe in it, I could point to that to show that why this book can't be a good book.
Okay. So I think you see that's a valid point, but here's the thing. There's a difference, I believe. For example, if God said to Muslims to persecute people, to punish people who do not believe or do good works, for example, people who don't give charity to the poor, that, you know, we should somehow punish them in whatever human way possible, that I believe would be a bad book. But a book that says, if you believe in me, you do good works, I will reward you in the hereafter. If you do bad, if you do evil, if you steal, you murder, you don't believe in certain things, you don't believe in me and do good works, then you will have the punishment in the hereafter. I think that's not discrimination, because remember, the people who do not believe in the hereafter should not be affected by that kind of warning, as long as the people who believe in it are commanded to do good to them. So for example, the only commandment, if I want God's pleasure, I have to do good to you. I cannot expect God to be happy with me by hating an atheist or hating a Christian or hating a Jew. I can only expect his love if I love his children, which is the whole of humanity. So that's the message of the Quran. And God has laid down his rules very clearly of what good is and what bad is.
I think what you're focusing on is the effect of what Islam will have on people in this life, right? But I'm going beyond that. I'm actually saying, is this a book true or not? Whether it has a good effect or bad effect, is this a book that is true, even if it has a positive effect, right? And I'm pointing out to that, even though I don't believe I'm going to go to hell, and I don't think that verse is going to have any effect on me, I could still use that verse to point to a Muslim that is having doubts about their religion, that how could you believe in a God that is all loving, all merciful, and yet will burn somebody forever simply for not believing in something. But you know, a lot of people, the reason why we started with apostasy and, you know, terrorism and stuff, is that something that you mentioned and something that you have to deal with, because a lot of people talk about those things when they talk about Islam. But I actually think that's actually a bigger issue, is going to hell, because, I mean, if you you could point out like, oh, Islam tells you to kill non-Muslims and that's horrible, so Islam is not wrong religion, and some people say that's actually not Islamic, some people say that's actually Islamic, but something that Muslims don't dispute is this, that, you know, now many people for their what they believe in are going to get burned for forever. And I think beheading somebody is such so much less of a, you know, tragedy to somebody than being burned forever. If you were burning me for 10 minutes, I would be glad if you behead me, you know. I would welcome being beheaded after being burned for 5 minutes. You know, so imagine somebody being burned for eternity, and even though maybe terrorism or like killing non-Muslims or apostasy or you know, how you treat women, these are things that moderate Muslims and, you know, traditional Muslims disagree with. The issue of the fact that some people are going to go to hell forever for believing in something is not something that is disputed among Muslims.
We don't believe hell is eternal.
God says it's eternal in the Quran. Everlasting. Oh, what? It does. I keep finding it.
It's going to be for a long period of time, but we don't believe it is eternal.
All right, for some crimes, it's going to be a long period of time, but there's also some crimes that it's going to be eternal.
We don't think so, because in the end, it says that hell is going to be empty, and the doors of hell are going to be just open, and there's going to be no one in there.
Okay, I specifically remember reading that it was, we could discuss this in another time, and whoever is watching this could, if they know if it's true that it's forever or not, they could comment. But I would be interested.
There's an article that one of my colleagues, Dr. Fahim Yunus, wrote about this, and it's on Huffington Post as well. I forgot the title, but it's about hell and 7 points about hell.
Let's figure that out later. I remember seeing that it was forever, and I was taught in school that it was forever, but that's, again, you could say that's just bad Muslim teachers. But anyways, even if it was for 100 years, that's, I think, still a crime, right? I mean,
The one thing we can agree on is that punishment should correspond to the crime, right? The punishment of anything should correspond to the extent or severity of the crime. Now, there are numerous verses in the people can go to hell and how people can go to hell. Mm-hmm. And for example, like the article that I just published about food crisis. God is asking people of hell how you ended up here, and their answer is, "Oh, we did not feed the hungry people." So not feeding hungry people or worshiping.
Or not anyone, believing. Or not worship, believing.
It's not about not believing. It's about worshiping someone other than God. That's shirk.
But there's a lot of times that the Quran mentions that they are in hell for not believing. It says
right,
that.
It says they're in hell for worshiping someone other than Allah. So
yes,
but it also
mentions that people are in hell for not believing Muhammad's message, Muhammad's revelation.
No, there's no such verse. There's no such verse that says you're in hell for not believing in Muhammad. Actually, there's a verse that says if you believe in Allah and do good works, Allah will reward you for that. It doesn't make it a prerequisite
there's a part of the Quran that actually mentions Muslims saying that it was our fault. We saw the signs, we saw the revelations, but we didn't believe. And
you're breaking.
Oh, can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can hear you now.
All right. Actually, I think there was verses in the Quran about people that were in hell, and they were like, "Yes, it's our fault that the angels." I think they asked for mercy, and the angels were like, "Weren't you given the chance to believe?" And they're like, "Yes, we did, and we didn't believe, and we were wrong," and they were basically told that they deserve where they are because they didn't believe. The revelations, the signs of God, and they basically
but I have a verse of the Quran open in front of me, and it's chapter 2 verse 62, and it says, indeed those who believe and those who were Jews or Christians or Sabians, those who believe in God and the last day and did righteousness, they will have their reward with their Lord, and no fear will be there concerning them, nor will they grieve. So it doesn't mention Prophet. Now it says Jews and Christians and Sabians. And actually, like I said, we believe even atheists will go to heaven as long as they do good works and they don't do evil.
No, well, okay, first of all, the Abrahamic religions, yes, there is a verse with regards to the Abrahamic religions. Let me just bring this up. So, but in that context, if you read it fully, it the Quran, with regards to the Abrahamic religions, not the other religions, believes that the authentic versions of Judaism and Christianity was in line with Islam. And if you believe in the version of Christianity and Judaism that is in line with Islam, then you're fine and you go to heaven. But again, if you believe in the Trinity, which they believe is not in line with Islam, then which is actually, I have not yet seen a Christian that doesn't believe in the Trinity, right? So based I'm not saying they're not out there, but I think like the vast majority of Christians don't fit the Islam approved version of Christianity. But let me just figure out which verse I'm talking to about.
But just to clarify, you know, when the Quran says Jews and Christians and Sabians, what it means is other religions, because these are the religions that were prevalent in Arabia at that time. It doesn't specifically mean only these three religions.
No,
anyone who believes in God and does good deeds, it's this verse. According to this verse, their reward is with their Lord, so they can go to paradise.
No, I mentioned idol worshippers don't go to paradise. That's shirk, right? So that's another religion that was prevalent at that time. Zoroastrians were prevalent at that time. Zoroastrians were the neighbors of Muslims. They were never mentioned as the people that would go to heaven. Hello? Hello?
I can't hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can hear you now.
All right. Yep. So I was saying, sorry, I get maybe it's bad internet connection.
No.
I was saying like, sorry, I didn't mean to get to this theological discussion. But I think it's interesting. I'm enjoying this, but
yeah.
But I just want to mention this one thing, and then I let you tell me why I'm wrong, and I'm not going to respond to that because I want to get to the point that you support secularism as well, right?
Right.
I'm just going to say this, and I'm not going to go do the we could go into these discussions about different verses later, but my view, based on what I've studied and what other scholars have told me and what I've read the Quran, it seems like is that you know, it focuses on Abrahamic religions, not because those are the most prevalent at the time, because idol worship is seen as shirk and that's condemned completely. They never mentions that idol worshippers will go to heaven. And Zoroastrians, right? These are the prevalent religion right next to Muslims at the time, and they're not included in the mention of going to heaven. It focuses on Abrahamic religions because according Muhammad saw them as his predecessors, basically the you know, earlier versions of the true religion until his religion came. But other religions other than the Abrahamic religions were never mentioned as authentic or as approved. And in fact, idol worship, which is you could consider Hinduism at that time, was seen as idol worship. And most religions in Saudi Arabia at that time was idol worship. And Zoroastrians were seen as shirks. They were mushriks, because they believed in two equally powerful deities, so that's shirk. And these people had no share of heaven. But anyways, if you wanted to respond to that, I will not respond back so we could get to secularism.
Sure. No, I think you know, we can discuss this in detail with particular references, because I have verses in mind, but I don't remember them exactly. But briefly, I'll just say that the way we understand Islam, and the way that Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, the founder of our community, has written in his books based on the Quran as well, is that God is a just God, and it is only fair that, you know, the punishment that he gives to people in the hereafter would befit the crime that people commit on earth. As such, like I quoted one verse, and there are other verses as well, the Quran makes it clear that people of other religion, if they, you know, as long as they do good works, they have their reward with their Lord. Now, I think what's important is how we humans are instructed by God to treat each other here on earth. And we know that God in the Quran has given man free will. He's allowed people to be Christian, to be Jew, to be atheist, to be Muslim. And he's commanded Muslims to be good and fair and just and kind to everyone else and not to judge anyone. And I think the problems that are surrounding this contemporary era right now, especially in the Muslim world, are that people don't realize this, and that's why we see laws like blasphemy laws and apostasy laws. But when it comes to God's domain, if I really believe that Allah is the creator of the universe and Allah is responsible for creating me, then I think that's a really big deal. And consciously and deliberately denying that in his face, I think, is a big sin. Now, again, we can debate on that theologically in different ways. But I think that consciously, and again, if someone has not heard of the message of Islam, or has not heard God's message, let's say someone's born and dies at the age of 50 in South America, has not heard of the message of Islam at all, there's no reason God should punish him. That would be unfair. That would be unjust, because he hasn't even heard that message. So whatever, in his relative circumstances, whatever way he does good to people and lives his life, he's going to be rewarded according to those circumstances. That is what I believe, and that is what the message of the Quran is as well.
Okay. We could get into more detail in that one later. But one thing I want to share is that you actually are a secular Muslim. That means that you believe that church and politics, or mosque and politics, should be separate. And correct me if I'm wrong, you believe religion should have no influence over legislation or politics. Is that correct?
That is 100% correct.
Okay. So why do you think most Muslims disagree with that, and they believe that Islamic law, do you agree that most Muslims disagree with that, and they believe that
many do, yeah, especially. So I think, I don't know if most, but yeah, many Muslims, and a sizable number is in Pakistan, I would say most people maybe disagree with that, and they believe in a political version of Islam. And actually, we didn't see this Islam until very recently, when people like Maulana Maududi wrote books, and Sayyid Qutb wrote books about jihad, and about the main objective of Islam being dominating the world and taking over all the world and imposing Islam on people and imposing the Sharia law, and by Sharia law, their specific understanding and version of Sharia law on people. Until this recent phenomena, we did not see a political Islam as such. Remember, in the days of Prophet Muhammad, and in the days of the early caliphs of Islam, there was politics and there was religion as well. But that is not because religion taught that politics should be should be a part of it. But it was just because Prophet Muhammad, remember, was also the head of state of Medina. So coincidentally, he was made by the caliphs of that time. But Islam, as such, is a religion that, or any other religion, should have no role in politics. We believe that spirituality is the main role of religion. The main role of religion is to, is to teach us how to live our life on earth, how to worship God, and how to serve His humanity. We should never impose any version of our faith on other people. This goes against the teaching of the Quran. There's no reason to believe that Islam believes in imposition by force, or it believes in theocracy. There's no support of this vision in Islam. And so that's why we oppose it.
Okay, you say it's...
And a good example of this is the state of Medina by Prophet Muhammad. We know that when Prophet Muhammad was the leader of Medina, he did not impose his version or vision on any other people. He allowed the Jews, for example, to be judged by their own Torah, and he didn't impose Islam on the Jews of Medina. He didn't impose anything on anyone. He ruled as a fair person, judged everyone according to what they believed in.
Wait, so first of all, you say it's a new thing, but it wasn't, it wasn't just after Muhammad, it wasn't just the four khalifas, it was all the other khalifas after too, until the end of first, World One, we had khalifas and Islam was within the government for many, many years. And actually, it's only a short gap where political Islam goes down and then it comes back up again. I mean, even when the time that during after World War, I mean, we had the Safavid Shia Islam that to gain power in Iran, and in, you know, we had the Turks, you had the Mongolians started using Islam as a political tool to gain power. I mean, right after the World War One, you had some period where it was weak, but then right after, you know, it picks up again. Even without, you know, you mentioned like terrorist groups or these fringe radical groups, but even if you ignore those, you had like Iran and then Saudi Arabia, and even in less hostile, less like hostile countries like Turkey, Malaysia, and in Turkey and Indonesia, that most, you know, are considered much more tolerant, still Islam is a huge political tool. Even in countries that they themselves consider themselves secular, still Islam is used as a political weapon. So I don't know if it's a new thing. I don't even know if it was ever not a political thing.
See, here's the thing. I think a Muslim who is ruling a state, for example, Turkey, right, or any other government which was Muslim, a Muslim who is ruling a state is different from political Islam. Political Islam, the way I'm defining it, is the way Maududi or Sayyid Qutb sees it. That is imposing Islam on people and not allowing freedom of people to believe in whatever they want to believe freely. That is what I'm saying by political Islam, imposing your vision of Islam or jihad on others, right? That is what people like Sayyid Qutb believed in. If there was a Muslim leader who judged everyone with equality or give everyone their due rights and give everyone their due freedoms, I don't think there was anything wrong with that. But by political Islam, I mean imposition of Islam on people. I think they should be, if a Muslim is head of state, that's a different thing. Than the vision of Islam or political Islam that Maududi and extremist clerics in the Muslim world believe in.
Okay, but you believe that there should be no influence of Islam in politics?
Not at all. Like,
okay, no legislation at all.
Not at all. Yeah, no. So it should be completely separate. For example, in Pakistan, there are blasphemy laws, right? There are, I think those are completely wrong. People, the government, or I can give you my own example. In Pakistan, I don't know if you know this, but I am considered a non-Muslim under the government, right? I don't know if, did you know about that?
That what? That you could...
That Ahmadi Muslims have been declared non-Muslims under Pakistani law.
Yeah, and Iran too, in Iran too.
Right. In Iran, it's not under government. Maybe people consider us. But in Pakistan, it's the government that considers us. It's a part of the Pakistani constitution. And the Pakistani law can jail me for 3 years if I call myself a Muslim. So this is the state directly interfering in the religion of its citizens. And we believe this is against the vision of Islam. We oppose this wholeheartedly. We believe that the state should have nothing to do with the personal faith matters or the personal religious decisions of its citizens.
So when all these laws and regulations that the Quran or authentic hadith offers, uh-huh, that are supposed to be used as, you know, punishment for this, reward for this, who's supposed to do that? People? Just, you know, vigilante justice?
No. Like, no.
If these rules are not supposed to be taken up by the government to enforce, are you suggesting that they were meant for that time only?
So there are two things. For example, the Sharia laws you're talking about, right? For example, the punishment for theft, the punishment for different crimes under Sharia, those are to be implemented by Muslims on Muslims, because those are laws that are revealed to Muslims in the Quran. Like I said, when we go back to the model of the state of Medina, Prophet Muhammad never applied the laws that were revealed in the Quran to non-Muslims. He applied those laws only to Muslims specifically and exclusively.
So you're saying they have their own separate, within the Muslims would have, but so you're saying it's okay to have these rules for Muslims, right?
I'm saying if these laws to exist, they're not, I mean, there's no practical situation where they could be applied to only Muslims. For example, in Pakistan, you would have to have like one set of laws for Sunnis, one set of laws for Shias, because remember, when you interpret the Sharia, even the Sunnis and Shias and different sects within Islam disagree on matters of detail. So you would have to have like 20 different laws for a certain country. That's not even practical.
But you agree that Islam offers some, you know, rules and regulations, right?
Islam says punish, for example, theft, punish this, punish that, yes.
Whatever the regulations are. There are some rules and regulations that Islam offers, right? And they meant, I mean, if it gives you rules and regulations, they meant to be enforced.
Enforced? I mean, they are meant to be followed in certain ways, but not
punishments are not, when you follow punishments, you're enforcing a rule, right? If you're following the Quran and the Quran says that the Quran or the authentic hadith says this is the punishment for this, if you follow that, you're enforcing. I mean, if you're punishing somebody for doing something, you're enforcing a law, a rule, right? I mean, when you say it's not on Muslims and not on non-Muslims, I'm not sure what does that mean, because I mean, atheists or activists are not out there to just protect atheists. We believe in human rights for everybody, not just, we don't believe in atheist rights, we believe in human rights, right? So we're advocating for Muslims as well. And I actually personally believe that the greatest victims of, not just me personally, a lot of people believe that the greatest victims of Islam are Muslims. Muslims suffer from Islam more than non-Muslims. What?
You mean political Islam?
Yeah, well, I mean, you disagree with me, but I think Islam is, Islam and political Islam are this, I think Islam is political. Go on.
Islam is centered on spiritual well-being of human beings. Of course, there are certain laws or certain rules and regulations that were revealed to Prophet Muhammad that he applied exclusively to Muslims, not to the Jews of Medina, because they do not believe in that Islamic Sharia. And I believe that at the current time, and there's a very good lecture by the fourth Khalifa of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community on this topic, at this present time,
By Osman?
No, Mirza Tahir Ahmed, the fourth Khalifa of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and so he gave a good lecture on Sharia and politics. And he said that Sharia can only be applied to Muslims but the problem is there's a Shia Sharia, there's a Sunni Sharia. Even within Sunnis, there is a Wahhabi Sharia, there's a Diobandi Sharia. There are different versions of Sharia law. So you cannot impose anything on people as long as they don't agree. But we can agree on certain principles that certain things need to be punished in society. But again, when you say political Islam, what I understand by that is an expansionist, supremacist ideology of people like Maududi, which is followed by ISIS, Al-Qaeda, and other people, where they want to spread Islam by force, by the sword, and impose their own... impose Islam on people by force. And I don't believe in that. I don't believe, for example, if you don't believe that theft should be punished in a certain way, you should not have to undergo that punishment. There's no reason why I should impose my religious understanding on you.
Could impose it on true Muslims.
If there's democratic agreement on that. So, for example, like I said,
the Quran never said. The rules and regulations offered by God should only be enforced if there's a democratic agreement on it.
So this is what I mean by that. See, there's different kinds of Muslims. There are different sects of Islam, right? not Iran. Let me give you two examples: Iran and Saudi Arabia. Not everyone agrees. I mean, Iran is predominantly Shia, and Saudi Arabia is predominantly Sunni. They have their different versions of Sharia. They have their own interpretations of different punishments for different crimes.
Yeah.
So you cannot impose, for example, if they don't agree on a certain thing, you can impose it on people who are not agreeing on it, as long as, you know.
So it's either, okay, so you're saying it's impractical.
At this time, yes.
It is. So the laws and regulations that God sent for people at all times and all places for all mankind are impractical.
They're just regulations. They're not, for example, you know, many people, even amongst Muslims, have a difference of opinion of the particular punishments mentioned in the Quran. For example, the Quran says punish theft, right? But it just says punish theft, and it gives you a punishment for that. But there are different schools of thought which disagree on what counts as theft to warrant that kind of punishment.
All right, I'm going to put my traditional mainstream Muslim hat on, okay?
Okay.
What if I say it doesn't matter if they agree or disagree? This is God's command. God's command is not meant to be up for democratic election or people deciding if they should, you know, adhere to it or not. If God says this is the punishment for theft, I don't give it whatever. I don't know if I should use certain words in front of you or not. But I don't care if the entire world says we voted and we said no, this law should not be imposed. If God says this is a punishment for theft, this is the punishment for theft. You have man's law and you have God's law. As a Muslim, I would choose God's law over man's law. So, you know, they would say that you're saying that people disagree on this issue is completely irrelevant. How would you respond to that?
So I would say very simply that Prophet Muhammad himself had a majlis shura. He had a consul. He had a body of consultation. He always consulted with people with regard to different, you know, different things sorry, go ahead.
Oh, sorry, but he consulted unless he had a revelation. He only consulted when he said, I have no revelation. But whenever he had a revelation, it wasn't up for discussion anymore. He was like, I have a revelation. And even sometimes he said, like, I don't really want to do this, but it's a revelation. So, you know, it's final. So he only had the, you know, shura and discussions with people when he was like, yeah, I don't know what to do, let's discuss this. But when right. You had a commandment from God, then nothing was up for discussion anymore.
That's right. But again, like I said, he didn't impose that on people who didn't agree with it, right? So for example, he didn't impose things on Jews in Medina.
Because I don't know which parts of the hadith, when you say he didn't impose this on the Jews and he didn't do this to Christians, I have a lot of examples of the times that he did, but these are mostly hadiths, and I don't know which hadith you consider authentic. The thing is that you're a kind person, right, that believes that, you know, you're a good person. So it might seem from somebody looking at it that any hadith that you find unkind, you will call not authentic hadith, and any hadith that is you find in accordance with what you consider human rights and not violating anyone's, you know, freedom, you will consider, if it's good, if it's authentic, if it's not good, it's not authentic. But some people say that's because you're a good person. Yeah, go on.
My yardstick is not, it's not when, it's not if I consider something good or bad based on human rights, it's the Quran. If a hadith is against the message of the Quran, then I wouldn't accept it. And like I said, the Quran does not allow its message to be imposed on other people. And that's actually the first, that's the first lesson of Sharia, is that Sharia cannot be imposed on people. See, Sharia is a very broad term, right? Sharia, for example, when I respect my parents, that's Sharia law. When I'm doing good to people, giving charity, that's Sharia. And Sharia cannot be imposed on people is also a rule of Sharia. It's something that a society voluntarily accepts on itself.
When God says, cut the hands of people that committed theft, how is that not imposing on the rule of God?
Again, that's a regulation that needs to be interpreted. For example, Prophet Muhammad did not go about cutting the hands of thieves. Because of this
based on this, I mean, tell me if this is, you consider this authentic or hadith or not.
Right.
Muhammad beheaded 200 Jews, in Medina. 600, sorry. Yeah. You agree with that?
No. So here's the thing.
But this is not authentic, right? I know this is, what was the guy, the first, but, biographer of
Ibn Ishaq.
Yes, Ishaq. I know he has
controversial.
Yes, it's very controversial. What about the part that some people he blinded them and he left them off in the desert?
Not at all. I don't agree with that at all.
And the part that he put he put fire on the chest of somebody and asked him where the treasure is? Didn't happen either.
I've never even heard of that one. Which book is that in?
I could check the source of these, but I read a lot of hadith and a lot of biography of Muhammad. Some of the cruel ones are from what Sunnis consider authentic hadith, and I would think that you would consider not authentic hadith. But what about the part that when Muhammad came back to Kaaba, he demanded some people to be killed, and there was a few people that were supposed to be killed.
Four people,
and two of them were poets.
No. So here's where I disagree. After 23 years of brutal persecution, in which many Muslims had died, in which the Meccans had imposed war on the Muslims more than three times. Finally, Prophet Muhammad came back to Mecca as a victor, right?
He came
victorious. He had the chance to actually take revenge and kill everyone in Mecca. No one could have done anything.
I've grown up in a Muslim country, and this is like this story has been told to us so many times because it's supposed to be the most merciful thing that he has ever done, because these are people that are, but that would be such a bad economical decision to kill everybody in Mecca. I mean, okay, but here's the thing. It seems to me that you are judging hadith, what hadith is authentic, based on the Quran, right?
Right.
And you're saying because the Quran doesn't force religion on anybody, any hadith that suggests any kind of forcing of religion cannot be authentic hadith. But at the same time, you acknowledge that the Quran does say that people with some certain beliefs will end up in hell. You say it's not forever.
With the condition that God is merciful.
but you agree that this merciful God burns some people for a very long period of time based on what they believed in.
And again, remember, this burning is metaphorical. It's in the hereafter. It's a metaphorical thing. It's not burning with fire. It might be even severer than burning. I don't know. It might be lighter. I don't know. But
it's bad. I don't know what it is,
it's very bad. Not bad. It's very bad.
Okay, it's very bad. It's like what they describe is like pouring molten lava on you in your throat. Okay, so it's very torture. Bad. I don't care if it's fire or if it's not. It's torture. Right? The torture.
It's very bad.
Torturing people for a very long time for believing in something, certain thing.
Correct.
And at the same time saying that you are free to choose whatever you want to believe in, and torturing people, like,
the world. Yes.
Yeah, but the thing is that you're saying you're focusing on this world, uh-huh. where when Islam teaches you that you should be focusing on the other world. Doesn't you agree? That the Quran teaches you that you need to focus on the afterlife. So,
correct.
But the thing is that the critics of Islam usually try to say, like, focus on the damage of Islam in this life. And that's why I think a lot of people that defend Islam always are trying to defend the fact that Islam doesn't harm in society in this life. But sometimes the apologetics, right, with defenders of Islam, their focus shifts based on where the attack is coming from. But the thing is that the Muslims that are not always in the practice of defending, they are always remembering, you know, their focus is usually on the afterlife, right? And I think that, you know, it doesn't matter if the harm to what you believe in is taught to be in this life or in the next life. I know I don't believe in the next life, but it's the teaching of Islam is that there's a penalty for not believing in a certain thing, right? So I don't see how is that, if that is not compulsion, right? It's kind of like saying, like putting a gun on someone's head and saying, give me your wallet or you die. Well, that person has a choice. He has, you know, he has a freedom. You know, you could say like he's not free because he has to give his wallet away, but you could at the same time say, like, no, he's free. He could choose to die, right? So, you know, you could say like you're free to choose whatever you want to believe in, but in freedom, it's in the sense that you're basically choosing to burn for a long period of time. But if that's not a contradiction, then you're choosing whatever you want to believe in and having penalties in this world for what you believe in should also not be considered a contradiction. So these hadiths that is telling you to do this to people and force this rule on people and do this to Christians and tax Jews and, you know, make these, all of this based on the Quran. If that's not contradictory, I don't see how you're dismissing any hadith based on just that as soon as you find it that is forcing religion upon people.
Yeah, I think your gun to the head analogy was, it's good, but it's very different because here the threat is real. You have to perceive a real threat for it to interfere with free will. For example, if I had a gun to your head,
hell is not real.
What?
Hell is not real.
If you perceive it to be real, then it's a real threat. Perceive it to be real,
and most Muslims do.
I believe hell is real. I don't believe it's a literal real, but I believe that there is a phase afterlife where somehow the spirits or the souls of bad people will be punished and those who do good will be rewarded. I believe in that. And so I believe that the hell and heaven are real. But I don't do good because I want to go to heaven, or I don't stay from bad because I don't want to go to hell, but because Islam actually urges Muslims to do good for the love of God and for to serve humanity for the love of God as well. So we do good things not because, oh my God, I want to go to heaven, so let me give this guy $20 because I want to go to heaven. No, because I really love God and I want to please God, not because I want heaven or I don't want to go to hell, but because I know, because I really have a deep sense of love for God, for my Creator. And if you don't perceive this threat as real, for example, if I put a gun to your head, and you know that the gun is not real, and the threat is not real. I mean, that doesn't interfere with your free will at all. You have free will.
But to the Muslim that does consider hell to be a real place, right?
So, for example,
the option of leaving Islam, right? Because leaving Islam will be considered.
If I considered heaven and hell real, why would I leave Islam? If I considered my faith real, why would I leave it? If I had doubts, for example, let's say I had doubts about Islam, right? Let's say I now have doubts. Oh my God, I think Islam is not a true religion. I'm starting to have doubts. Then, of course, at that point, it fails.
No, it fails to become. I will tell you that it doesn't work like that for many people. Like, because I was a Muslim at one point, and when you're having doubts, hell doesn't just disappear like this. Hell is still a great threat and a nightmare when you're having doubts about Islam.
So were you a Muslim because you loved God or you believed in God, or you just feared hell and you loved heaven, you wanted to go to heaven?
I was, first of all, I was a Muslim because at first, because I was born in Iran. That's why I was Muslim.
Yeah.
Secondly, eventually when I was a teenage, when in my teen years, I took Islam seriously because of my love for God. I believed I had a personal relationship with God, right? But at the same time, when I had started having doubts about God, I felt him being disappointed in me. I felt him, his shame. I felt his disgust. I felt that I'm, you know, opening the doors of hell to myself, right?
Uh-huh.
And you know, that's really scary. Okay, like uh-huh. your doubts is opening to you, and you think that you might be damning yourself to eternal torture. You know, this, I don't know if I could explain the psychological torment that that doubt introduces to you. It would be so easier to just try to ignore the doubt and just be safe and stay with it. You know what I mean? Just put that doubt away. Why would I risk going to hell forever, right?
Yeah.
So just forget it, you know? So I think that sounds like putting a gun in someone's head if they're trying to
get it. That means you still have faith that the gun is working.
Yes. So when you're talking about atheists, you're like, oh, if you think the gun is empty, so that's not a threat to you. But I'm just saying, look, it's not just about atheists, right? It's about
Muslims.
It's about Muslims. As well.
Again, like I said, you see, it's free will. If you don't believe in, first of all, it's not about the gun. It's not about the gun at all, because life is not about, oh, you came here, now do bad and I'll give you hell. Here's the gun on your head. It's more about behave yourself, love humanity, do good. But if you don't do good, then you will be punished. So it's a set of rules and regulations.
It's not just about doing good and doing bad. It's also about accepting Islam or not accepting Islam.
It's not, like God. I showed you the verse. If you don't have to be a Muslim to go to heaven. It's not about that at all. There's no monopoly of heaven on. Actually, Islam is the first religion that says there's no monopoly of
can
heaven.
Should I read you the list of verses that talks about what happens to disbelievers?
And what do you mean by disbelievers? Well, a Muslim can be a disbeliever. Remember?
Yeah, but I'm a disbeliever. I'm a disbeliever in Islam, right? And many verses that talks about hell and who ends up in hell starts with, oh, you who disbelieve. Uh-huh. Don't you know what the hell's going to happen to you? Aren't you afraid? Right. Don't you know what we have prepared for you? Like, we brought you signs and you didn't believe, and you're going to be, your punishment is going to be, you know, hell.
I know.
In fact, I don't know if it specifies. I think disbelief is, you know, hell and disbeliefs are mentioned together more times than hell and any other action. Maybe a close second is shirk. I don't know. Go on.
You know, but when it says disbelief, remember that term is used in different meanings. For example, like I told you earlier, actually, I probably did not, but it says if you don't pray, you commit disbelief, right? If you miss one prayer, you're committing disbelief. That doesn't make you a disbeliever per se, but of course, at that certain time, you're disbelieving.
Okay, but I'm a disbeliever, fully. Like, I don't know about part-time disbelievers, okay.
But
I'm a full-time disbeliever.
There's a very good article by an atheist. Actually, you know what, if you want, I can leave the link below this. It's written by an atheist on this very topic of why the argument that hell and heaven should threaten people is actually, it doesn't hold water at all.
I personally experienced the threat. I don't know why it shouldn't hold water. I don't know how could somebody decide whether I should be threatened about something or not. I was threatened by it. I saw it as a real threat. Is that person arguing that?
That was when you believed it was real.
Yes.
And now you believe it's real.
Yeah, but I'm talking about the Muslims. I'm talking about Muslims, not about atheists only.
I can tell you, I'm not threatened. I'm not. I don't do things because I have this gun on my head.
But every time I reach out to Muslims,
right,
and every time, especially sometimes some of them are doubting, sometimes some of them are not.
Uh-huh.
But at least, like, I don't want to say most or majority of the time, a lot of the times it will come out to hell. What if there's hell? Aren't you afraid of hell, right? Seems like it to me, it seems like a major block to doubt, right? And if that's not compulsion, if that's not forcing people to stay within Islam, then that would be the argument that the person that is putting a gun on your head and asking for your wallet is not forcing you because you could choose to die. Because for me, that's not a threat, but for a lot of people that might have considered doubting Islam, that seems like a huge block. Did this person that wrote this article, was he or she talking about atheists, or was she talking about other people?
I think it was about both, but I can check and let you know. I read this about a year ago, but I can look it up. I can dig it up again.
Even if nobody took it seriously, I still mentioned this to show that this book could not be real, like from God, from a merciful God. Even if nobody took it seriously, I think they should take it seriously. In fact, as a Muslim in Iran, I was shocked that people didn't take it seriously, right? I thought about hell all the time and heaven. Mostly hell, because my mother didn't pray, my father didn't pray, and I was worried that they're going to end up in hell. So the thought of hell was constantly on my mind. Not for me, but for me too, but mostly for my mother. You know, that image of my mother burning in hell was a major issue. It was like mental abuse a little bit. But I don't know. I'm just saying that you're saying it's not a real threat.
No, I don't think so. See, here's the Quran, if I believe in God, it comes in a package, right? If I believe in God, if I really believe, truly, honestly believe that I'm created by a creator, and I believe in his message, and I believe that because he created me, he has rights over me, and he wants me to do good, and he wants me to believe in him, and if I do good works, he's going to reward me. If I do bad, he's going to punish me. I feel he has the right to. Then as long as I believe that, I think it's true. For example, if I live in the United States, I know that I live under the U.S. government. And if I do certain things, I will be punished under the U.S. government. I don't feel threatened, like, oh, my God, you know, if I steal, I will be punished. I don't have free will. No, I don't feel that way.
If the United States would burn you for stealing, then I would be really scared. I would be scared of one day, like, I would get the hell out of there as soon as possible, even if for any crime. If United States burned people, even for the most heinous crime, I would get out of that country. I would think a country that burns people for any reason is not a country to
again. Again, I think the problem here is you take the things in a human literal. And again, like I said, in the hereafter, as we Muslims believe it, it's not humans, it's something very bad, but it's not literal burning. Of course, it's something very bad. And if you do bad,
if it's as bad or worse than burning, then why is it an issue that it's not literally burning? It's as bad as burning.
It is torment.
Okay, if it's torment, then what is the issue that it's not literal burning is not the point here.
Fine. But what I'm saying is, my point is this. If you're saying that the idea that you'll be punished in the hereafter contradicts with free will, and I'm disagreeing with that. I'm saying that if I live in the United States and I know I'm going to be punished for a certain crime, I don't think my free will is taken away. Like if I steal, I will be punished. And it's like a gun on my head, I can steal. It's not taking away from my free will. I can still steal if I want to, but there will be consequences.
Okay.
For every
exactly. I agree. I'm not saying it's against your free will. I'm saying if that is not against your free will, right? Then oppression against non-Muslims is also not for compulsion on religion.
Oppression against non-Muslims is clearly forbidden in Islam.
No. But you're saying your argument for why that's forbidden is because the Quran teaches to each their own religion. Everybody is free to choose their religion. And you use that as evidence that then we should not force religion on people.
Oh, definitely.
But you at the same time say that having consequences for your actions doesn't mean that you don't have free will. So by that logic, if you get if God says there is no, you know, anybody could have whatever religion they want, and at the same time says there's consequences for not being a Muslim, bad consequences in this world for not being a Muslim, by your logic, these two are not contradictions.
They're not.
So by that logic, the verses in the Quran that says there's no compulsion in religion should not be considered a contradiction to the hadiths that tells you to kill apostates or
no. There is a clear contradiction on that because that's affecting your free will.
No, you just said it doesn't affect your. You just said having consequences
in the hereafter. It doesn't.
What? Wait. So you're saying because the example that you gave it was actually for the United States.
Oh yeah,
Your example. You said if in the United States I have consequences for my actions, that doesn't mean that I don't have a free will. And that's in this world, right? So by that logic, I think it means that if Islam introduces negative consequences in this world.
Yeah.
For you not choosing Islam, that's not contradictory to.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Now I understand your point. I think that doesn't apply here, and this is why. See here, when Quran makes it very clear, Quran doesn't say let him who will believe and let him who will disbelieve, and whoever disbelieves, kill him. It says to allow freedom of conscience. For example, in another verse, it says there is no compulsion in religion. It's clear you can't force religion on anyone. La ikraha fid din. There is no compulsion on religion. It doesn't say let him who will steal and let him who will not. I mean, it's in terms of freedom of conscience, it's very, very clear. And at the 12 instances where apostasy is mentioned in the Quran, at all 12 places, it mentions the same thing. That at actually a few places, it does mention punishment, but not human punishment. It says that, you know, I will take care of them later. Like it never, not even at a single place does it mention human punishment for anything. Okay. So no, I don't think that applies here at all. There's complete freedom. And this is what we see in the life of Prophet Muhammad as well. So I give you the example of the Christians at the time of Prophet Muhammad. They came to visit Medina and he allowed them to worship in his mosque. He did not. Oh, you are Christians. You are not accepted in God's kingdom. You know, get out of here. You're unclean or whatever. He had debates with them there. And clearly, it's clear from history that they did not agree with what Prophet Muhammad said because they did not become Muslims at that time. Later, they did. And he allowed them to go back. I mean, it's not like they were free to come to Medina, debate with the Prophet of Islam, and leave with freedom. And then later, I don't know if you're aware of this charter that Prophet Muhammad had with the Christians, in which he said anyone who hurts Christians, who kills a non-Muslim, he will be his enemy on the day of judgment.
Of the Abrahamic religions. I'm not disputing the fact that Muhammad was not, you know, more accepting of. I mean, Muhammad did not was you know more accepting of of Christians and Jews than ISIS, of course, right? but maybe not of Hindus.
Don't know that there were no Hindus there, but based on
teachings. Okay. But
they were idol worshippers there. Actually, we can actually even say about Hindus because see, here's the thing: there were non-Abrahamic religious people there as well. There were people who worshipped idols in Mecca. What did he do to them when he came to Mecca? Did he kill them?
No, but they all had to accept Islam.
They didn't have to accept Islam. He said, whoever accepts Islam.
But they all did, though. They all did, though. So you don't know.
Well, they all did. That's right. They all did.
Do you think they all had a change of heart and that one, on that fateful day, or were they all impressed by the large army of Muhammad that showed up at their doorstep?
I think they were all convinced that this guy who's forgiving us at this time when he can kill us, he's gracious, and I, you know, we've been attacking him for 23 years, and this guy is coming here and certainly he forgives all of us, he doesn't punish us. And actually, you know, Ikrimah, the son of Abu Jahl, fled Mecca because he was afraid that Prophet Muhammad would kill him. Yes. He came back and accepted Islam. Why did he come back to accept Islam? Why did people return to Mecca to accept Islam?
One thing I want to say is that even after Muhammad, right, Muslims were more accepting of Christians and Jews than Christians were of Muslims and Jews, right? And you know, yes, it's true that throughout the history of Islam, tolerance towards Christians and Jews for its time was more progressive, right? But not by today's standards, you know. By those days' standards, it was progressive, but not by today's standards.
What is the difference between the tolerance then and now? I think.
Imagine if you went to United States and they said that, you know, we're gonna put you in a protective class, and we're gonna protect you, but just give us extra tax. You as Muslims, you have to pay extra tax. I think you would be pretty offended by that, wouldn't you? I mean, you would try to fight that, wouldn't you? Like, what kind of country will try to tax me extra based on my religion? You know, wouldn't you have an issue with that? If United States tells you, like, you know, it's okay, you can be Muslim, just don't talk about Islam to non-Muslims. That's illegal, you know?
I would definitely be offended by that, by either of those two scenarios. But none of those two scenarios applied to the time of Prophet Muhammad. Listen, the jizya, which you talk about, the jizya tax, which was, I mean, every citizen pays tax, but the jizya tax was less than the tax that Muslims paid, which was the zakat. The zakat, which is roughly about 3%, 2.5% of one's income or whatever, was much, much, much higher than the jizya tax, which was smaller.
With jizya tax, you can't necessarily say that, because there's lots of variation based on specific location and specific times that you.
But I'm talking about the general, it was much lower. And actually, I can quote many non-Muslim historians on this as well. But the jizya tax was actually much smaller. And of course, they had to pay tax. Every citizen has to pay some tax in return for the protection they get from the state. But if I would actually be really happy if the United States says that as a Muslim you're going to pay lesser tax to the IRS.
Actually, first of all, I don't know if it was less taxes, right? Because based on what I've read, it was not the case. But maybe my sources are wrong. We could talk about that later.
I can leave you a good article on that from
Islam. But even if I would be up as. I would still, if you went to the United States and the United States told you that as a Muslim you get to pay less taxes, you would be happy. I think you should fight that as well.
I will not fight that, dude. Come to America. Come and live here and see that.
No, I would. If the government told me based on if I had to pay less taxes, more taxes, different taxes, no taxes, based on religion.
Yeah,
I don't think that's, you know, I don't think that's acceptable, even if it was as a favor. You know what I mean?
See, I think it. You see, look at it this way: in those days when there was in the time of Prophet Muhammad, and in the times of early Islam, Muslims were paying the zakat, right? There was no alternative to that for the non-Muslims. Since you cannot impose a religious tax on people, right? I can't impose zakat on a non-Muslim, and see that as something very enlightening for that time. I mean, Muslims could have forced the zakat on non-Muslims.
So you agree that you should impose zakat on Muslims. You should, is it okay?
I don't think No. Zakat was never imposed on people. Even if you study history, people who were poor,
Muslims had the option of not paying zakat.
Of course, poor Muslims
when you say zakat was more, well, that was enforced.
Muslims were obligated.
The jizya was forced.
No. Jizya was never forced. Not at all. Actually, was never enforced on people.
We have to compare sources because
I'll be happy to provide you sources. This is a misunderstanding. Neither the zakat nor the jizya was imposed. There's a difference between obligation and imposition. In America, if I don't pay my tax, the IRS is going to come get me and I'll probably be in jail for not paying my taxes. But there was no such thing as imposition. Yes, okay, there was an obligation.
But there were
poor people who did not pay taxes.
But do you even care about what the Muslim community did after Muhammad? Don't you, it seems like you seem to want to focus on Muhammad's time, right? And when people mention, I find that like sometimes when you mention, Muslims when they're trying to defend Islam. When they talk about the golden age of Islam, they keep on using examples of why Islam was good. But whenever you show bad examples of the same time, but Muhammad's time, you have to focus on that. But whenever it is good example, they keep switching based on, right?
I made that clear in the first few minutes of this discussion that the standard for me is the Quran and the established practice of the Prophet Muhammad, I'm not responsible for what what happened in the Turkish Empire, right? I'm not responsible for that. Islam is defined only by what the Quran says and what Prophet Muhammad, practiced. I admit and I am sure that there are Muslim states that have done wrong things. I'm sure there are, but generally speaking. Even in the later stage of Islam, under Muslim governments, Jews and Christians were protected. Like you just said, there were higher levels of tolerance in those communities, and non-Muslims were taxed the jizya, but the jizya was less than the zakat. Of course, in this day and age, that wouldn't apply. And actually, there's one prophecy by Prophet Muhammad as well that in the latter ages, when the promised reformer comes, the jizya will be abolished. And of course, I believe this is that later age. But yeah, I mean, basically speaking, the jizya was a lesser tax, and it was not imposed, but it was people were obligated to pay.
So there are sometimes when you find a teaching in Islam that seems problematic for our time, and then do you believe that there are some teachings that were only for a specific time?
There are certain verses of the Quran that relate to historical incidents.
All right, the Quran and and the teachings of Muhammad are supposed to be a role model and a teaching for all people at all times, right? But it seems like both traditional mainstream Muslims and then you have the moderate or liberal Muslims, I don't know, progressive Muslims, uh-huh. that both of them use the same arguments on their side. Like, for example, you see the traditional Muslims when they have they verses that they don't like they disagree with, they say like, that was only for that time, and the verses that they want to be used now, they say like, that's for all times. And then you have the same as modern Muslims making the same arguments but for different verses, right? And and also when it comes to metaphor and what's literal and what's metaphor, they keep switching on and off based on what they want to be true and what's not want to be true. You see sometimes the same thing in Christianity. Any verse or that in the Quran that it seems problematic sometimes all of a sudden turns into a metaphor, but any verse that you find, if people find useful, all of a sudden becomes literal. So how do you, you know, with all these disagreements among Muslims about what verses are correct and what verses are not, how do you know, you know, you say you use common sense to decide which ones are true, but that's exactly what they say. They're saying, like, it's common sense that this is true, and that's what they're using, their common sense. Are they lying? Are they not using their common sense? Are they, like, are all these Muslims around the world that are disagreeing with you on your interpretations, do they lack common sense? Are they being dishonest? Like, what do you think?
I think most of them are being dishonest, and I include Al-Qaeda, ISIS types, and I include people who oppose humanity.
Okay, here's the thing. I'm not talking about Al-Qaeda, ISIS. I know those are used as examples for people to show. I'm not talking about fringe radical groups, right?
Right.
I'm talking about mainstream Muslims that disagree with you.
You're talking about, for example, people who believe in apostasy laws and blasphemy laws.
You know, it's not just
Sunni population.
Exactly. It's not just Al-Qaeda and ISIS that believes that apostates should be killed, right?
Yeah. Again, that's very, very easy. The easy standard, again, like I said, again, is the Quran and the established practice of Prophet Muhammad. Let me give you the two examples that I quoted, the blasphemy laws and apostasy laws. On apostasy laws, like I said, the Quran upholds freedom of conscience. And I believe that, and every Muslim believes that the Quran is the gold standard in Islam. Can anyone give me one example of Prophet Muhammad killing someone for leaving Islam? And there are numerous people who did leave Islam and went to Mecca.
So I actually can't give you examples of that, but you will say it's not an authentic hadith.
Go ahead, let me know.
Okay, I will send you examples of that, but you will tell me that. But your argument is going to be that it contradicts the Quran, so it's not authentic hadith. That's what your argument is.
I have not heard a single example of someone who's been killed for apostasy. I have heard of hadiths where people, some like new atheists or extremist Muslims, claim that people were killed for blasphemy, but I've not heard of a single one who was killed for apostasy.
We mentioned that there's at least three hadiths that Muhammad specifically says that people, Muslims, could be killed for leaving Islam, but then you say that that's not really leaving religion. That's treason, right? That was because of treason. And the reasoning you give for that is because, it contradicts the Quran if it's not because of treason. Is that your argument?
Argument. The other is the context in which it was said. Listen, like I said,
the context is, it has not much more context other than the fact that somebody asked Muhammad, is it okay to kill Muslims? And he gives you three examples of where it's okay to kill Muslims. He never mentions treasons. He just mentions people that were Muslims and leave Islam. But you are somehow seeing, I would be a mainstream Muslim, right? I would put my mainstream Muslim hat on again. I would say, Muhammad, why would he play riddles with you? Why would he, if he was trying to give you a message, why would he hide it in an enigma that you have to realize that it's treason, where he could have just said treason instead of saying leaving Islam? Wouldn't he save a lot more people? You know, how many people have died because of apostasy laws? Wouldn't it be more easy for him to just say, I don't agree with killing people for treason, but wouldn't it be, even if that was okay, wouldn't it be okay for him to just say that instead of...
How do you know he did not say it?
Well, that's what I'm asking you, How do you know that he meant treason? I don't even know if any of the hadiths... To me, all of the hadiths could be completely made up. And you know, actually,
It's possible. We have to evaluate every hadith on its own merit. Like I said, for example, after 200 years, what if I said Armin Nawabi said that, whatever, XYZ, I made up a statement, of course, and there was no record of that. I mean, there are five generations between you and the person who's reporting that. So the first thing is everything, and compare that to the Quran, which is the word of God. You cannot compare the two things. It's like comparing a randomized controlled trial.
Actually, I can't. First of all, two things. If I can't tell anything which hadith is true, right, at all, when the Quran says use Muhammad's life as a role model, it's giving me an impossible advice. because it's basically telling me to follow a role model of somebody that every record I have of him, I can't even verify if it's true, right? The verification model that the people call scientific in Islam is actually not so very scientific. It's based on trustworthiness of people in the line of who said, you know,
he said that guy said that.
And then, you know, I mean, that's, if that's scientific, I don't know what's unscientific. But here's another thing. Why is it that you have this level of skepticism for the Hadith? Why wouldn't you have the same level of skepticism for the Quran? Why wouldn't you think the Quran?
Because I believe that the Quran is the word of God that was collected in the life of Prophet Muhammad. I know that because there is no difference in the Quran that we read today and that you have billions of copies in the world. It's the same exact to every dot of it compared to the one that was first compiled at the time of the initial phase of Islam.
But Umar himself said that there's part of the Quran missing.
Who said that, sorry?
Umar, the second Khalifa. And Osman also had to burn copies of the Quran that were contradictory to the...
If
Osman had to burn copies of the Quran that were contradictory, that means there were copies of the Quran floating around that they weren't the same as the original Quran. So how do we know that the ones that he burned were not the original Quran? Maybe the one that you have right now is not the original one. The one that he burned was the original one. In fact, we have stories of Aisha changing a verse in the Quran after Muhammad's death, right?
I'm not aware of that change, but I'm aware of the fact that you're right that a few counterfeit versions of the Quran were being floated around
They were counterfeit? How do you know they were not the ones that Muhammad said and the one that Osman kept?
Yeah. See, here's the thing. There's one thing that's common and there's one thing that comes up. And of course, remember, people had committed the Quran to memory. They were huffaz, right? They were hafiz.
And the huffaz disagreed with each other. Many huffaz disagreed. One of the huffaz that Muhammad claimed to be one of his best disagreed with Osman's version of the Quran. There are entire surahs that are missing from the Osman's version of the Quran that some huffaz wanted in.
And who was, and who was this?
What?
Who was this hafiz?
I could send you the link.
Okay, we can exchange this.
We could exchange this offline. But the thing is that let's say that I'm wrong, right? Let's say these sources, these are not just me saying it. This is Islamic scholars saying this too, right? We have authentic hadith that Omar says that, you know, nobody should claim that they remember all of Quran because not all of Quran is written, right? There are many of us that say that, oh, I remember this chapter of the Quran that never made it in, right? And let's say the Aisha story that she said that she changed the verse. Maybe it's true, maybe it's not true. The thing is that it seems like a circular reasoning to say that we know that the Quran has never changed. The Quran is real because it has never changed. And then I say, well, how do you know these stories of the Quran changing are not true? Then how would you respond to that? How do you know that these, what if one of these, how do you know these stories are not true?
See, again, these stories are hadiths again, right? They're still hadith.
Yeah, but I'm not saying they are 100% true. I'm not saying they're 100% true. I'm not saying trust them to be true. But I'm saying, how do you know 100% that they're not true?
Oh, I don't know. I don't know 100% if they're not true.
Okay, but if you say that they're, you know, you can't say 100% they're not true, that means you can't say 100% that the Quran hasn't changed.
One thing I can say is that all Muslims of the world, all 1.8 billion Muslims of the world today, believe in the same version of the Holy Quran, the same Quran. And we believe that this is the word of God. So if you want to argue on any topic, be it apostasy laws or whatever, the primary argument, the primary source of jurisprudence will still remain the Holy Quran in the same version as we know it.
I mean, and all, then the, when, all the, I mean, the story of Iliad by Homer, everybody believes the same story. Everybody believes that the Iliad, there are some very ancient books about ancient stories, right? That today, nobody, the story is from that author, if you ask everybody what that story is, nobody will contradict what the story is. So what that mean? But that does that mean that that story is divine because nobody disagrees about the story that that author wrote?
Oh no, no, I'm not saying that. I'm saying this is the version of the Quran that was revealed to Prophet Muhammad. Whether it's divine or not, whether it was true word of not is a different debate. I can disagree. For example, the ahadith, I treat them as the same way as I treat the Gospels. The Gospels were written much after Jesus, not in the life of Jesus, not at least in his presence, right? So
I don't dispute the fact that, almost all, I don't know if there's any Muslim that doesn't believe in the final Osman version of the Quran, right? Actually, there is one verse that Shias and Sunnis disagree with the vowel, but that's beyond the point. Because the vowels were actually never in the original text, so many people argue that the vowels are not even part of the Quran.
Right.
So the black ink without the vowels, that part, all Muslims agree with that, right? But the issue of whether it's, I'm not disputing that. If there is one Muslim or a few Muslims out there that dispute that, they are so fringe that they could be ignored. But what I'm actually saying, how do you know it's divine?
Oh, that's a different debate. You know, how do I know, why do I believe the Quran is the word of God? It's a totally different debate, and it comes down to So it comes down to a few things. I mean, one of them is prophecies that are mentioned in this book. For example, in my an article which I recently wrote was How Science Brought Me Closer to God. And in that article, I quote the Quran, where the Quran is mentioning certain scientific truths. For example, it mentions that the universe was created from a tiny mass which exploded. A tiny mass which exploded. So that's, now we know that the Big Bang is a reality. Of course, and things like, for example, the universe is accelerating at a rapid pace. Things that we only found out a few years ago.
Okay, I have comments about that, but if we go that way, this is going to be a whole new discussion on its own.
Yeah, I know. I don't have a lot of time right now because I'm going to move fast.
Okay, but just before you go, because I know we went off through, but my main hope for this discussion, this was really, for me, this is really interesting. That's why we got distracted. But
me too.
But from people to see, both Muslims and non-Muslims, is that you support freedom of expression.
That's right.
That you believe that people should be free to criticize all views, atheism, Christianity, Islam.
That's right.
You support secular values. You believe that religion should not be involved in politics. Uh-huh. My question to you is, we could disagree on all these other things, right? Like whether Islam is a good religion, bad religion, whether there's a God or there's not a God, right? And we could, there's nothing wrong with us having this disagreement and debating against each other. Uh-huh. But since we have some agreements with regards to freedom of speech and secularism, do you think there's a way that we could, work with each other to help each other, especially because, I think in many countries, Muslims are oppressing atheists, right? And limiting their rights to freedom of expression. And us as atheists fighting for their right to express themselves, not just atheists, anybody that goes against the grain, you know, anybody that goes against what's commonly believed. Us as atheists, many Muslims don't take us, take our views seriously because we're atheists, we're heathens, right? But I think there is an opportunity for atheists and Muslims that support freedom of expression to get together because I think Muslims that do support freedom of expression and secularism don't get enough attention, right? And I think by shining a light on these people and more, I mean, you're doing a great job to bring more attention to yourself and people like you. And I think us also as atheists, if we could demonstrate that, you know, there it's possible for somebody to be Muslim and also support freedom of speech and secularism, we could provide, you know, I mean, I'm still going to try if a Muslim is, you know, openly trying to talk to me and is welcoming me talking to them, I'm still going to try to show them why Islam is wrong. But at the same time, a great alternative is for more Muslims to support freedom of speech and secularism. And Muslims that already do support freedom of speech and secularism to feel less afraid of speaking out, right? So do you think there's a way that we could work with each other to do that?
I think so. You know, I completely agree with your comments that more important, we can always agree to disagree, and that's the way to go. I completely believe that there is a creator. You believe that that's probably a fairy tale, and we can always agree to disagree on these issues. What is more important to our human life on this earth is our freedoms, our liberties, our rights. And we know
you got disconnected. That was a good part too. Are you there?
Or states that call themselves, hello?
Can you go back a little bit because you got disconnected for a second? You were saying that
we can agree to disagree.
Yeah, okay.
Yep. Yep. And I was saying that states that calls themselves, you know, Muslim states, for example, Pakistan or Saudi Arabia, they do have laws that limit the freedom of speech of not just atheists, but Ahmadi Muslims and other minority groups as well. Bahai. So, for example, yeah, exactly. So, for example, in Pakistan, hundreds of Ahmadis have been killed just because of their freedoms. And I don't have the freedom to say I'm a Muslim in Pakistan. I can be jailed for 3 years. Mm. In Bangladesh, just recently, we saw that 3 atheist bloggers were killed. We know that an atheist blogger, Raif Badawi, is in jail in Saudi Arabia.
Well, I don't know if he's atheist, but secular for sure. I mean, yeah.
Okay, secular. Okay, fine. But atheist, secular, Muslim, or whatever different kind of people. My point being, there are many different freedom, many different prisoners of conscience right now, and many of them are sadly across what we call the Islamic world. It's very disturbing, and personally, I feel it's very frustrating that, you know, this is all being done by governments who work in the name of my faith, like Pakistan and Saudi Arabia. So I think, when I initially started talking about freedom of conscience, I met many atheists on the internet, and I'm really glad to connect with you now. But I told you about Kyle Jones, another atheist activist whom I met online. We have formed a group called Ahmadi Muslims and Atheists for Freedom of Conscience, and I would actually urge people to join that group. And you know, I'm very glad that I have you, on board as well. And what we do is we write about these issues, we raise these issues online on different forums, just to raise awareness and just to let other Muslims know that this is the right thing to do. As a Muslim, we should be speaking more than other people for the rights of everyone, because our faith explicitly requires us to do so. So I think we should have a coalition like we already do, but this should grow over time, and we should speak about these issues more and more on social media. Social media is a great tool to harness, you know, people who think like you, and to actually speak with people who don't think like you to try to convince them to do the same things that you do. So hopefully, in time, you know, we can have a stronger coalition and speak up for these people.
And even I agree with everything you just said. And I also want to point out that even when you talk to people that don't agree with you, even if you don't change their mind, I still think it's a success, because you're demonstrating that disagreements does not have to lead to hostility.
Right? Exactly.
Even if both sides of the argument come out without changing anything about their initial position, them, you know, they just showed to other people that they completely disagree with each other, and none of them thinks that the other person should be silenced, and neither one of the sides hate the other person because of what they believe or don't believe in.
That's right.
That's still, even if we don't change people's minds, I think that's still a success demonstrating
that. Right. I completely agree with that. That's right.
Great. And I will, you sent me two articles of one about your group and one about the apostasy. I will add the link to both of those in the description of the video for anybody that, and that's a good place to find you as well about the group that you're starting.
Yeah, I mean, that group is a good place. Or my Twitter is Kashif, which is my first name, followed by MD.
Okay.
So Kashif MD is my Twitter. I have a public face on a page on Facebook as well. So anyone can follow me. And
okay, I'll link to all of them then.
Thank you so much, Arvind.
For anybody that is interested in getting in touch with you more.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. And I hope this is the first of many interactions we have.
Yes, me too. Very much.
All right. Thank you so much. It was nice talking to you.
You too.
Bye.